we never should have Chris in the other room. As soon as that came up,
I know,
we lost the expertise that we get out of a Joey JoJo.
This would never happen under a Joey JoJo rule. Never.
Never.
Has anything like this even happened to you, Joe?
Not once ever.
Chris is on the horn, though.
Yeah. He's all over it. So I don't think that we're on the air, or else we're just on the air on some bizarre channel that we don't even know about. Somebody is saying,
they put me on hold. I believe I made a fix. I will give updates as soon as I can when they get me off the hold music.
Well, I don't think that you got a fix, because I'm looking at the Twitter bitching about it right now. So there's no way to you to know that you're on the air.
Yeah.
See, I've worked at radio stations where that if it was in your headphones, you were on the air. But that's not necessarily true here.
We're living in a new world. A new shitty world.
Yeah, it's just a bizarre thing. So if we are on the air, let us eventually know.
I just got a text just now. Someone feels like we are on the air.
Yeah, but did you get that from Chris?
Mm-mm. Oh, we're
back on the air. I got off the hold music. They're saying that we're on.
Well, why are you yelling at me?
Sorry.
So what happened there? We'll try to find out.
We were just going about our regular show. Meanwhile, we knew nothing.
Hey, let me talk to some of these panicking people. Hey, Bennington.
Hey, Ronnie, what's up?
Hey, what's
back
up?
Back on the air. You guys are live now. You just kicked back over.
Peace, thanks.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Love you guys.
Thanks. And all the phones are falling off at the same time, as quickly as they came in.
They're first responders, though.
So, yeah, they were first responders. What did you do wrong, Chris?
Engineering's looking into why we were on, why we weren't on the air. They said they were going to call me back, but we are on live now.
I'll tell you why. Because we moved you into that room and the great Joey JoJo, my tech boy, my millennial, out of that room.
Have you noticed we've never had any problems with tech boy?
Zero problems with tech boy.
I pride myself in that.
Now, the producer that you replaced, that Chris used to fight with all the time, you claimed we had constant tech problems there.
Yeah, nonstop technical problems.
Oh, is that what tech stands for?
Yeah, I just went long form.
That's good. So we did not. Now you'll have to read. Oh, well, he's on the phone. Because we'll have to redo Chris's announcement that he was so happy about, and to show you what a fuck up is. He called something the best day of his life while Shade 45 music was blasting over him.
It was the best day of his life that was being simultaneously ruined.
Right. As the worst day in his life. So you're not going to say it as happily as you did before.
Everyone, I'd like to announce.
Oh, God. Everyone.
Do it really
Who
good.
Who actually says that? Everyone. Who are you talking to? The people listening?
The people listening. The listeners.
We don't call
yes.
them everyone.
The wonderful listeners, I want them to know that Vice magazine wrote up that I, Chris Stanley, am a budding Periscope star, and they gave us to Chris Scope Bros Stanley. That's Vice magazine.
Why would they call you a butthole star?
They said a butthole Periscope star named Chris Stanley.
Periscope's own Chris Stanley.
Down, 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 down. Hey, Chad, Wisconsin.
Yeah, good morning, Bennington.
Yeah.
First of all, your opening song was great. There was at least 30 N-words in that rap song.
Yeah, that's just something we thought we'd play.
We're going to be edgy today.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good call. Say, last night on the Opie Radio Bennington Show replay, I did my first Periscope. So I Periscoped your Periscope.
Holy
oh my
shit!
God.
Oh! Yeah. Meta!
Woo!
Meta,
how about that?
Meta.
I had I was on for 16 minutes and I had 12 followers.
Cool.
That's nice. Great. So, great for effort.
Did any of them ask you to show Bob's?
No. No. Just thought I'd share that with you guys.
All right, thanks, man.
Excited about it. Thank you.
Yeah. So that's Chad in Wisconsin. He periscoped the Periscope.
I'm going to go back Periscope that replay of his Periscope.
Who do you got running phones today?
That's Kashmir.
He's got to be trained on how to lock it in and hold it and all that kind of stuff. You know what I mean? I don't know that you've been busy with your guy, Jam Band, who after talking to yesterday, I feel really bad about Chris letting him fall through the cracks.
Because if that had been reversed, if let's say he had taken Kashmir and you had taken Jam Band, that would be like a rough cut diamond that we wouldn't know that Kashmir was brilliant.
He's great. Really hard worker. Really great dude.
And it comes from having a mentor.
You got to get him on the air.
Yeah.
You got to get his creativity in there. Yesterday, well, first of all, Vice, Periscope's new stars. But now there's even an article about we are the first radio show ever just to broadcast on Periscope as well.
First ever?
Yeah, the first ever in the history of the world.
Wow. I hope Vice writes about that.
I don't know. They seem to be Chris guys, and Chris does, he likes his solo projects.
He does.
To play bigger than the band.
It just seems like there could have been maybe, I don't know, a panel mention.
Yeah.
I mean, the panel.
You do have a panel on that show.
STL. Scope Talk Live. Great show.
Yeah, but why didn't that make the big Vice article?
Oh, no. I'm going to try to get a hold of this writer.
No, we don't want your charity mentions.
Yeah, you're right.
What?
I thought we did until you said it. I forgot about the dignity thing, and I'm like, good, get a hold of him. fucking fix that.
Look, Scope Bros, we're all part of the Scope Network.
Really? Because I don't see my name there. I don't see Joey Jojo's name there.
Where am I?
I don't see Dan. Hey, I'm out with comedians Perlman there doing one-liners.
Hey, you guys are Scope Bros. Chris Scope Bro Stanley.
I, you say that, but Vice doesn't. And I go by what Vice says.
I always go by what Vice says.
You fucking changed, dude, since this happened. You're as cold as Vice. You're as cold as Vice. Willing to sacrifice our love. What does that even mean? Willing to sacrifice our love.
Wouldn't you have to be pretty warm to do that?
Yeah, and Foreigner, you've got to really explain to yourself. Then you came right back with Hot-Blooded. I mean, what's with you and temperatures? My favorite song that they do is called Lukewarm.
I like that
and
one.
It's about a kid. His name is Luke. Lukewarm.
And that's finally a happy one because it's the extreme temperatures, I think, that really bothers him.
Yeah, that's the extreme. He's hot-blooded, he's cold as ice, he's tepid. One of the songs is just called Tepid.
I can't hear that word without thinking of Jeffrey Gurry and Returning Water. It's tepid.
I can't drink this under any circumstance. There's no cubes in it.
Tasteless. It's tepid.
It's tepid. Nothing's going to... Can you take back all the food as well? It's unbelievable. And he's sitting with a table of guys leaned over, just fucking eating and not giving a shit about anything.
Non-stop. Constantly about the water for like a half hour.
Where is she now? I mean, half of these people are speaking French.
Now I have no water. That's
now I have nothing at all. I licked my armpit for half an hour, hoping to get some non-tepid sweat. Poor Jeffrey.
You know.
But there's something about those dudes that if they get one problem, you hear about it for days. You know what I mean?
Like, obsessive.
God forbid they crack a tooth and they think should be on CNN.
Get over it.
I don't know why he came up with crack a tooth. Out of anything that could happen. Because he didn't. There was no reason for it.
This is terrible.
I can't have anything cold. Which, as you know, all I care about. Remember the other story.
Now I'm forced to drink tepid.
The fucking Jeffrey, to me, the funniest story that he ever said is that he remembers the first day pizza came to the Bronx.
He said that once when I was in the room, and I cannot believe that to be
true.
You
had to stop him.
No, Jeffrey.
It's filled with Italians who have had the fucking pizza forever.
What is this newfangled dish?
I like it to cool off a little bit. You know, that way I'll go with my cold water. I hope I get a cold water. If not, I'm sending back. Yes, here's, he looks at the menu. What do I want to send back? What is it that I want to complain about? I'm sorry, there's cheese on my grilled cheese.
That's what you ordered.
That's how it's made.
I was in a deli yesterday, and there was a woman in front of me who decided that she wanted something sweet from the, like, bakery section, and proceeded to ask the price of every fucking item. And, like, from reoccurring, everything's between $1 and $3. None of these. And the brownie. And the cookies. Okay. What about that cake? How much is that? It's all about the same. What the fuck, dude? Who the fuck has that? Nothing is going to be $20, I assure you.
I don't know if I have enough money for that cookie. It looks delicious, though.
And this is an adult woman, like a well-dressed adult woman who can spare the extra dollar if it's the brownie that she really wants. I was going crazy behind her.
Do you realize how great Earth would be if there were no people?
Oh,
this would be the greatest fucking planet.
Paradise.
It would be.
Who do you scope to, though?
Just a scope of one.
Yep. Wow. I give myself my own hearts, you know?
It finally happens and you drop your phone and it breaks and you're like, no, I had time now to scope.
Good reference.
Thanks.
Real cool.
Yeah.
Super not dated.
No. Current. Very fucking current.
Just today.
Yeah.
I think.
Is what he's wearing, would that be called a fleece? Is that
that is, yeah, like a performance fleece.
Thank you.
Now, it's too warm of a day for you to have this fleece on,
it's a
right?
pullover fleece.
I mean, that's a depressing February thing to put on. Like, I don't care what I look like, but I'm warm, you know?
Yeah. It's, well, it fits you beautifully.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, my friends pointed out that it looks like a dad fleece, and I should just have it forever. So that when I have kids, I can take them to soccer.
Well, you could put on 200 pounds and you'd still fit in that fleece.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. But I can't see you being anyone's dad.
I could adopt.
Here's what I think. I bet your sperm needs glasses. I'm going to say that. You know what? Two times last night, I was fucking sitting there and then started laughing, thinking about Joey Jojo and his brother crying together on that missed field goal.
It was the saddest day ever. My brother, that brother, is actually coming to New York in 2 weekends.
Scope it.
Scope it.
Scope it.
I'm going to scope that.
Scope
he's a younger
family.
Older brother.
Older brother, 27.
And how old was he? He was like...
He was 10 in 1998, and I was 8 when the field goal miss occurred.
And then... Tell me what happened. Just say it like we never heard it. Okay. I want to hear it again because I love it so much.
All right. So in 1998, my brother and I cried one time watching the Minnesota Vikings because in the playoffs, we were in the NFC Championship against the Atlanta Falcons. And
who was the quarterback then?
Randall Cunningham.
It was almost a perfect season.
Almost a perfect season. Chris Carter. Randy Moss, Randall Cunningham. I think Michael Bennett was on the team. He was our running back. Anyways, I digress. We were watching the game. Gary Anderson, who hadn't missed a field goal all year, steps up, and right before the field goal, this to win the game, my brother goes, "Don't worry, he hasn't missed all season." I'm like, "Oh, yeah." And I hadn't learned about the heartache that Vikings fans experience yet. And he lines up. We're inside in the old Metrodome. And he kicks it, and it goes wide. And my brother and I, we just start sobbing immediately. Just start crying. And it was one of the worst times until, you know, 9/11. Every other season.
Oh, like you stay with football.
Yeah.
But was your dad there while you two were crying in the middle of the living room?
I think he was.
I just think it's funny. Two brothers crying really hard.
It's not fair.
I wanted to win so much.
Which,
me too.
I, yeah. Both of us did. And now we're not winning. No. No. The other team's happy. We're not.
This is the exact opposite of what I wanted.
It's just so fucking funny. And like pure. It's the purest thing of these two innocent boys. Confident that the guy would do the same things he did, and when he goes away, they just start bawling. It's so, it's such a great image that whenever I would think about it, I just would start laughing. It was, first of all, I did not expect him to say that. You know, most people don't fucking ever tell a story with, and then we both just started crying.
In unison.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds like the pussiest kids ever.
Jose!
No, I know. Everything about it makes sense. And yet, it's fucking so hilariously stupid.
It was the first time I had really gotten my heart ripped out.
Oh, yeah.
First time with many with that team.
Well, you had a magical year that year. I mean, you were truly, seriously, if that team goes on, and by the way, Atlanta just shits the bed in the fucking
Super Bowl.
Who beat them?
I don't remember.
Whoever it was, I remember thinking, I wish the fucking Vikings were in this game.
Right.
Broncos.
Was it not even a good game?
No, they just got fucking wailed on. 34, what was it?
34-19.
Yeah. And the Vikings would have made it a really great game. It would have been an exciting game. But that happens in sports. It just, it's over fast. It's like if you've ever been to a prize fight, everyone is going crazy and then a knockout happens. And you just turn around and everyone's just left. You know what I mean? Like, there's no, you have no idea. It could be in the first round, could be in the 15th round. It's just over now. Boom. It's done.
A lot of hype before then, though, huh?
Where's everyone going? Why don't we sit down and just fucking keep having that experience we were having a couple minutes
ago? We're all sharing this bloodlust for so, however long.
Who's playing tonight? Tonight's, I think, this is how late we are in the season. CBS has lost Thursday Night Football already. They've moved it back over to the NFL Network, which puts us about halfway done. It feels like we were waiting and waiting for football.
Yeah.
And now it's almost done.
It feels very uneventful, but I don't know if it's just because it's uneventful in my house.
It's uneventful.
It's Browns and Bengals tonight.
I think even if my team was undefeated, I'd still say this is a shitty year.
There's still like four teams undefeated.
You should be happy because Johnny Football starts tonight, or are you finally off that fucking bandwagon?
I'm jumping back on once he gets back into the game.
Is he going to beat the Bengals tonight?
He'll beat the Bengals tonight. They'll be 7-1 after this evening. I called the Packers losing last Sunday on Smoking with Chris.
Jeez, you called them losing to probably the best team in fucking football. So exciting, Chris, that you were able to do that.
A lot of people thought Aaron Rodgers couldn't be stopped. 77 yards. That's what he gave you. Total. That's what he gave you. I'm not even sure if he could beat the Panthers this week. He's on the road again.
You don't think he could ever win again now.
After that.
Matt, what's up?
Ronnie B., I hate to admit this, but Joey Jojo, you're not by yourself. As a grown-ass man, I, too, came to tears when the Vikings lost that year.
Thank you, Matt.
Just started crying.
It's brave to say.
It was so heartbreaking.
Yeah.
I think I had to get in my car and ride around, and I put a big dip of skull in and just was by myself in my tears and this. Pissed off at Anderson.
What hurt more, 1998 or 2009?
98, because that was the year that if we would have gotten that, I think we would have finally won one.
I'm with
Favre
you, man.
It hurt, but it was just Favre being Favre, but 98 hurt the most.
I miss that's really brave of you to admit, Matt.
Yes,
you could start some kind of fucking group for men. Yeah. You started crying during that play. But, yeah, You see that sometimes, like at a stadium, the photographer will catch a thing of someone crying over their team. But there's so much emotion that's taking place before that, you know?
I mean, I know that feeling of, like, it seems like your guts are being ripped out. I just, only because it happens in my house every day.
You don't need to be tied into it, though. You don't care enough.
No, but I do want it to go well. For everyone's sake.
Hey, there's a piece, I think Chris found it. Drunkest fans in football.
Yeah.
Now, I purposely didn't look for it. But being a guy who went to Eagles games, it's hard for me to imagine there's a drunker stadium.
The drunkest fans in the highest.
Well, you don't want to just fucking start from the top, dude. You want to give us some backstory. You want to be a what? A presenter, right?
Presenter.
A performer.
Yeah. All right. So they found this out by there's an app company that can tell people's BAC how much they'll blow up after drinking. So that's how they found out who the drunkest people are in all these games.
So they go division by division, Chris.
Yeah, and they go division by division.
Can you find it, or you want to play a game with us, or
no? Let's play.
Let's just yell it out.
No, I don't want to just yell it out. That's crazy. I'm bringing it up now.
So we're guessing by team, which team's fans.
I can't imagine that we're doing anything. Let's see. This came up, and I was pretty weirded out about it, but it seems like furries are into Tony the Tiger in a big, big way.
Yes. So Tony the Tiger has an official Twitter account, and someone happened to be going through and realized that Tony the Tiger is getting just constant sex tweets to him from furries all the time. Nobody else is tweeting Tony the Tiger, because why would anyone else?
Right.
I mean, who would actually send Tony the
Tiger
a tweet?
Are they doing this as a joke?
Well, they thought about that, but most of these accounts are existing accounts with, like, furry history and interest and other tweets about being furries.
But are the furries at least saying, hey, let's do this as a joke, you think? Do furries have a sense of humor about their desires?
I'm not sure that they do, or if they do, I think that it is dwarfed by their boners for animals.
That was blunter than I expected. They're boners for animals, which do not equate with animal boners. These are different things.
Very different. But I would imagine that if one were a furry, Tony the Tiger would be a big sex symbol.
But
I mean, he's very muscular.
But he's not fur.
He is supposed to be fur.
But he's not, though. There's no even... But costume, Tony the Tiger costume.
But they get off even on the cartoons of animals as well.
This is
so
funny.
It's not just, because I remember thinking that too, like the furry thing was more like the plushy vibe where they were into the feeling of it. But these are people who are into, what is that, like anthropomorphic or something like that, where there was like human-like qualities on animals. And a lot of that is about the cartoons of those animals. So they're really into even just the images.
That
so
is weird.
Tony the Tiger is like a ripped-ass dude, I guess. I mean, I never really thought about it, but...
Yeah, I never thought of it either. I never thought someone could be sexually turned on to a cartoon.
But I love the idea that some intern is in charge of Tony the Tiger's Twitter, and he has to go through furry tweets all day long.
All right, let's just throw this to Joey. If you could have sex with a cartoon, who would it be?
Lola Bunny from Space Jam.
I don't even think that she's 18.
Yeah, I think that's an underage
That's
animal.
Disgusting.
Well, I mean, I was 6 when she was around.
You're not 6 anymore.
That's
you can't
true.
Say that, Your Honor. The reason why I was having sex with this child is I was once a child. Stanley, how about you?
The Lion King, Simba's girlfriend in that.
Nala?
Just gonna say Simba.
Nala. Yeah.
Again, underage. Very underage.
Yes. She's like a cat.
Yeah, but in lion years.
So you're a cat man, huh?
She was definitely sexy.
Now, by the way, I even said, cartoons, there's no reason you had to pick an animal cartoon.
Oh, I thought that's my answer was going to be that, too. Let me rethink.
No. I definitely want to know your cartoon animal. Or spirit animal, as you call it. What do you got?
I was going to say, from Disney, Robin Hood, who was a fox, and he was a foxy fox. And I remember when I was young, feeling like he's pretty sexy. And
really?
I don't really understand
Roger why. Miller voiced that, which is kind of odd. Maybe you just like country music.
Maybe that's what it is.
All right, I'm going to date myself here, but I'm going to say the very beautiful Anne Margrock. hey, Dan, how did last night's one-nighter, one-liner go?
Night of 100 one-liners.
That show was great. It was super fun. It was awesome. I mean, there were so many great comics there. It was really,
really... Did they get a nice audience?
Yeah, it sold out.
And they raised the money they wanted to raise. And...
Yeah, they raised, like, I think $50,000 for Eric. And it was, yeah, it was really
one
great.
One night?
No, that was through the GoFundMe and everything. And I'm sure they got
so
a
they
lot
hit,
for the
open. They hit their thing for GoFundMe.
They hit the goal, and he was there. And, yeah, it was a really, really great night.
You know, I was looking at Eric yesterday, and I know the stage four limb. I think he's faking. Because he seemed very healthy. Mm-hmm. And
you think it's a career move?
I don't know if you could be that sick and that quick. He's very quick.
He did draw a lot of people, more than he would have if he just played his healthy card.
Absolutely. If I knew he was healthy, I wouldn't even have plugged it.
You wouldn't have gotten 100 opening acts. So.
I certainly wouldn't have given to the GoFundMe if he was healthy.
Yeah, but there was some headliners there.
Yeah, they were great. It was awesome.
Give me your one-liner now, because you didn't want to do it yesterday, because you didn't want to burn it the way Joe burned his.
I just said we have freedom of religion in this country, but we only do that. They only gave us that because there's only Christians walking around. So they're like, yeah, freedom of religion. You could be anything from Protestant to very Protestant. We don't care anywhere in that.
Seems like a lot of lines for a one-liner, though. I was listening to period after period there.
Some people really went long, and a couple people when their one-liners bombed, they're like, wait, no, I can't do that. Let me do one more. And so someone did like three
or
four.
Who had the best one-liner all night?
Man, some guys like Eli Sayers had a really good one. Gary Gulman was great. I don't remember what his was, mm-hmm. but yeah, no, I mean, there's some great comics.
Was there a winner? Did they crown a winner?
Becchione.
I mean, everyone won except Bergstrom.
Oh.
Cancer.
He'll win now. That $50,000 is going to make him feel pretty good about himself.
It was very fun. And Mindy was there documenting all of it.
Let me tell you something.
Great photos.
I know that you're in love with Mindy. We all get it.
Yes.
But she's dating the guy from...
WFMU.
Yeah. Now, Chris Stanley would probably let you shoot him up with this disease for the 50 grand.
Are we talking guaranteed 50 grand here?
Yes, it's a guaranteed 50 grand.
Things are sounding pretty up for me then.
If seriously, what price to shoot AIDS into your body?
God.
No, you know they've got a lot of great medicine for it now.
Yeah, I mean, now is it straight to AIDS or is it HIV first?
No, I'm going to shoot AIDS.
Straight AIDS.
But manageable. If you then manage yourself after.
Okay. $40,000.
$40,000?
What about this? Type 2 diabetes.
$1,500.
What? Seriously, this could be some kind of weird fucking thing that we could get rich guys to do.
Yeah.
You know how rich guys like to get together and just fucking auction off what they would be willing to shoot Chris Stanley up with?
It's like Trading Places, but with a lot of diseases.
Yeah. What about colon cancer? What would you take?
Oh, man, that the asshole.
Yeah.
It's
actually deeper beyond the asshole.
Yeah, it's not just the hole.
You're
thinking of a polyp.
It's hemorrhoids.
Yeah.
$30,000. I think I gained the full AIDS is the high end.
That's not even going to cover your medical expenses.
I think $30,000 is going to go pretty far.
He doesn't pay medical expenses anyway. He puts that... he calls his credit card the free card. And I go, it's not free, Chris.
No, this is free.
But they just give it to me. I don't hand any money over. I just give them the card. Don't you realize this?
In the future, you'll just have to put your eye up.
Mm-hmm. Retina scan.
I don't like that because then it'll just lead to people getting their eyes ripped out of their head. We don't know.
Why you always got to be a fucking glasses half full kind of guy, Chris? Why can't you be positive?
I'm just looking out for people's eyeballs.
He said to me one day, what's the date for dystopia? I go, we don't even know if it's going to happen. It'll be a utopia.
When the cannibal gang is going to start running around with gas.
When Joe's brother gets here, let's all go out to a Vikings game with those and pray for a loss. And they all start crying.
All right. Hell yeah.
Don't do that.
You go to a Vikings bar?
Yeah. Bar None on 13th and 3rd here in Manhattan. It's half Saints bar, half Vikings bar.
I don't like that.
I don't like it either.
One or the other.
Yeah.
It's neither then. It's just a bar. it's not a Vikings bar.
But Vice's fair-eyed child might be right about this.
Listen, Chris Scopro Stanley's laying some truth down on you. You're living in a crazy fucking dream world if you think that's a Vikings bar.
The fact is, you can only be one thing to be that kind of bar.
Yes.
Yeah.
Fucking Steelers bar is we also like the Falcons. No.
All right. By the way, then you're saying that your team is who, Chris?
The New York Mets were.
No, you're a football team.
Oh, Giants,
team.
Giants.
That means that they have never had a stadium because they share.
I never liked it. I never liked that at all. I'm agreeing because I think that fucking Jets should get the hell out of there and find someplace else to go.
It's actually more of a Jet stadium than the old one. They don't even name this after the Giants anymore.
Nothing but disrespect. Why doesn't Eli get some love for once? It's just called Eli Stadium.
I wish that we would find out that, oddly enough, he was switched at birth with Eli Whitney. And that's why some games he just seems to be interested in cotton.
We're not running the cotton gin play again.
BD, Chris, what would you take for venereal disease?
Are we talking like gonorrhea, herpes, like in that area?
All the above.
Oh my God. Okay. Yeah. All of them. $15,000. I mean, I'm talking gonorrhea too, right?
Yes.
But not AIDS also? Is that their own?
No, okay. No, I'm going to leave AIDS off that one. AIDS has moved on to their own thing.
Okay, separate category.
Yeah. It's category.
Syphilis too. I'm going to go crazy possibly from this.
Oh, yeah. It'll eat your brain.
Yeah, because it's the 1920s. There's no treatment for it.
That's part of the deal. He's not allowed to seek treatment.
Sorry, Al Capone. You're riding this one out yourself. I don't know. That Chris, he short sells himself. I'm sure we can leave here with a kidney of his any day we want it.
Oh, yeah.
The problem is we can't resell it anywhere.
You wouldn't even need cash. You just need a half a sandwich.
We would fucking put his kidney or our liver in someone else, and they would immediately die from alcoholism.
He's been soaking in vodka for years. It's pure. It's pure alcohol.
Sad that you joke about it, but I saw the movie Barfly, and I know how you guys are. There's just no bottom at all.
All my friends are here. All my friends.
These are all my friends.
Drinks for all my friends.
Radar tried to, I think it was Radar Online, did a blind thing of some big movie star who's had full-blown AIDS for the last couple of years. And then everyone spent the comment section trying to guess who it was.
So they never revealed it. They were just saying.
In a blind thing, they're just like, major movie star known for his tattoos and sleeping with prostitutes. Cried to friends that he's full-blown AIDS.
And he's been hiding it for years. I read the same blind item.
Yeah.
I was commenting in the section there. I was throwing stuff out there.
who was your guess?
Charlie Sheen.
No, they said giant star. I think they said even movie star. First of all, nobody would be shocked anything about Charlie Sheen.
I think the thing is like that they're just so freaked out by that they want to say anything. So I think that's what Charlie Sheen is, because this is my theory, that Charlie Sheen didn't want to like disrupt any of his fans, any of his Tiger Blood bros.
Disrupt them?
Freak them out. Though he hasn't really worked since that freak out.
What was the thing is with lots of tattoos? Yeah. That was the clue?
My guess was Martin Sheen until I heard that one.
Martin Sheen is very clean. He's a clean machine.
I was going to say Kiefer Sutherland, but I don't know how he is with prostitutes. I just know he has a lot of tattoos.
What about Danny Trejo? Machete. He has a lot of tattoos. And that guy's lived a rough life. He went to prison. I think it's Danny Trejo.
What fucking thing is... What universe is Danny Trejo a fucking movie star?
Machete! That's a movie. He was the star of it. He was in Heat.
Yeah, he's been in a lot of films, but no one would say, here's the movie star, Danny Trejo. I will tell you the name that most commenters picked, and you guys haven't come up with it yet.
It wasn't Kiefer?
I think I know it.
What?
Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
I did not see that name come up, and wow. That almost makes me a little sad just to even think it could be him.
He is all tatted up.
Yeah,
he loves whoring.
Yeah, that part's not true. He's not a whore master.
He doesn't seem like a whore master.
So you get another one.
Ring rat, sure, back in the day.
A ring rat. I met the sweetest ring rat the other day. She was waiting outside the locker room as I was leaving with Coco Beware.
Honestly, she was a ring rat with a heart of gold. It's hard
I think
to believe.
They all do, you know? They're there to kind of move the sport along. But you want me to tell you who the commenters believed it to be?
Yes.
And I don't believe it to be.
Can I have one more guess?
Yeah.
It's Johnny Depp. He's tattooed.
Johnny Depp's name did come up, but number one on the list, friend of Johnny Depp's, Mickey Rourke.
Oh,
no.
You guys are acting like the commenters, but no, anything that you guys don't.
Mickey. No way. No.
M-I-C. See, you're looking kind of sickly. K-E-Y. Why don't you go to the doctor? So I hope it's just a bullshit story and it's no one.
I hope it's no one.
But how can you have gossip about someone's disease anyway?
It's disgusting.
I know. And all this came because Dan did a fucking one-liner thing. Here's exactly what happened. All right, NBC yanked a Donald Trump promo. I was talking about this on Opie Radio today with them. Didn't seem like it was that big of a deal. I don't know whether you saw this, but a lot of Hispanics were bitching outside of 30 Rock last night.
Yeah, I did see that.
If you're against Donald Trump, I don't see this show helping him in the long run.
I would agree with that. I also just find it weird the things that people find the energy to get behind when, I don't know, this is like, it seems to me like there's more energy behind this than actually like snuffing out his actual campaign.
Yeah, it's true.
Or, you know, like, you're angry at SNL. Why? Like, I mean.
Well, they want the ratings. They want to have a big night where everybody's watching. Who's a musical guest, by the way?
Sia.
No, Sia.
Sia.
Sierra is no one, I don't think. I mean,
Sia!
Sia! Sia!
Love Sia.
Yeah. I don't think this is going to be an overly funny show. Can you imagine first of all, you'll get one fun. Like, this promo is all you're going to really be able to do. Because he'll always be the Donald Trump character in every sketch.
Why was these promos so Cecily heavy?
They always pick out one person, and then you get to do the promos with them.
Gotcha.
So, it was her time.
I would say, can I hold out for someone else? No, I'll do next week. You got this.
The show, Saturday Night, will go on, though. I'm giving credit to SNL for being able to stand up a little bit.
Yeah.
Next week, I think they want to do Quentin Tarantino. They're just trying to do...
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Subsetting people in opposite directions.
And then, oddly, the group, the musical group, will be the Police, but not with Sting. It's just Tarantino actually in the Sting position.
Great.
See, I do support the Police.
Message in the bottle, yeah. But I'll tell you, there can't be a weirder lyrical song than Message in the Bottle, as far as being a big top 40 hit.
God, I can't even think of the verses off the top of my head.
It's about a guy literally fucking putting messages in a bottle, you know?
Literal?
And then
I never really thought of it, but I didn't think it was literal.
And then the end of it was, at the end of the song, there is, because he's so lonely, he puts this message in a bottle, And then there's 100 million bottles washed up on the shore. They heard his, the world heard his SOS.
Oh, okay. It's sending out an SOS. Yeah. I remember that part.
It's fucking ridiculous and asinine. And you wouldn't imagine any band could be that blonde to fucking write this song and put it out.
I think someone would have gotten help. And they're like, I'm just going to throw another bottle into the ocean.
What? He was a fucking cell phone.
Yeah.
Well, no, he isn't looking to be taken off the island because he's stranded.
Oh, that's weird.
He's lonely and needs someone.
That's the SOS.
Yeah.
Friendship.
Companionship.
Love.
Love, Kelly. If I was the police back in the day, like if it was 1979, 1980, 1981, I would have put an album with the three guys in the front and say, which one of us is Sting? Would have been with the title. Because they all look the same, and yet Sting was the sex symbol.
All the same color and texture hair.
Yeah.
Not only length, but texture. You think at some point somebody would say, all right, somebody's going to have to change up the look. This is getting ridiculous.
I play the drums. No, you can't just hold drumsticks.
I think this might have been the only band to leave when they were completely at the top. You know what I mean? I think at the time that they broke up, they had like the number one album,
really?
Doing the number one tour, number one single. And they were like, I think this is it, guys. I don't think there's anything else we can do. And Sting wants to go make a jazz album.
Yeah, normally it's not a choice when people break up. They've already been through a hard time. So much stuff going on out there.
Yeah, it's a weird day today. I keep thinking today is a Friday.
Yeah, so you would, because you did a double.
But we're doing a double tomorrow.
We are doing a double tomorrow on OP Radio.
The Big Bennington Show.
Yep.
Then we'll be doing this show tomorrow, and then Saturday at 3 p.m., GPS.
GPS on Channel 27, D-Tracks. I'm very excited, and I will be doing a pre-show scope.
You're first.
Yes. So you can follow the iBang.
By the way, Periscope. You know what all the guys were asking me tomorrow? They're all going, are you going to have Billy Joel? Billy Joel. This whole thing's going to center on Billy Joel.
That's what they were asking you?
Yeah, and I'm going, no, New York City, not Long Island.
Mm-mm. Yeah.
New York City.
No, Billy Joel's not in it.
Mm-mm.
I'll tell you that right now. And I don't like to give out spoilers on GPS, but I'm happy to give that one out.
You're not a Billy Joel person?
I'm not a Billy Joel person. I don't have some sort of weird, like, loathing about it. And I totally understand, you know, people out there, that's their guy. They love him.
Do you have a band that you hate, or do you just... Because I don't think I have a band that I completely hate the way I'll talk to people and they're like, oh, I hate some band. Can't stand them. Chris Stanley, I already see you waving at me.
I hate Dave Matthews Band. I can't stand them or their fans.
Yeah, I mean, I guess
I don't think you do hate them. I think you don't like their fans.
Don't like the music either. Like, it's a silly, like, ants marching song. It's ridiculous.
I mean, I certainly remember that kind of feeling when I was young.
Right,
like, when you're young, you feel so passionately. Like, why is Creed popular?
And right.
You're angry.
And you were right. Yeah. You were right to say that.
But I feel like as an adult, I don't have that as much where...
Yeah.
Even like, I would be like, I don't care for that group or that's not really my genre or whatever.
It doesn't make you angry that they found their own audience.
No, not at all. But when you're young, especially when you're talking about popular bands, because that's usually where the hatred comes from. It's, it's kind of worthless to hate a band who's not very popular.
Now, Joe, do you have someone that you hate?
Not anymore. I can't think of one, but it's the same thing. When I was young, I hated any like scene band, any emo band. Because they weren't
Give
Hendrix.
Give us one in
Panic at the Disco. I hated
I loved Panic at the Disco.
It's a great fucking name.
Why didn't you like them?
Mainly because I guess everyone else in my high school liked them. You know? But also, I was like, Panic at the Disco. I get it. You guys sing loud. It's cool.
It was very loud.
But then
loud.
Again, I was going through my Zeppelin and Hendrix phase, and anyone who wasn't them, I hated.
Billy in Oklahoma.
Intense, deep-rooted dislike of Billy Corgan, Smashing Pumpkins, anything associated thereof, except for that Asian chick that played the guitar.
Well, Smashing Pumpkins were one of those bands that people would get really angry with. But I thought a lot of it just came from interviews.
Yeah.
You know? Do you think Dan even cares enough about music to hate some band?
I think he'll have somebody that he hates. I can't imagine who it's going to be, but I bet he does.
Metallica.
Really?
Okay.
I think that's from associating with middle school. A lot of my friends liked it, and I didn't like it, so I think I had to take a stronger stance of hating them, and it's stuck.
Do you hate all metal or just Metallica?
It's particular for Metallica.
But across the board, you don't like metal.
I'm not a metal guy, no.
Yeah. Metal seems one of those things that you're in or you're out, you know?
1 minute you're in, the next you're out with metal.
Still an impression.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Now, do you think, and I'm not even picturing that he could, but do you think Kashmir hates a band?
Mm-mm. No, I don't think he does.
I don't think so either.
I think
he just likes pops. Kashmir, come on over here and let us know, is there a band that you absolutely hate?
I hate U2 so much.
What?
Your whole generation hates U2. Why?
Because we're raised in, like, I remember in middle school, all the teachers loved them. And I'm like, are they a philanthropist or are they a band? Like, they're great. Like, give all their money to who they want to save, but just don't sing shitty songs.
Give me a shitty hit song.
Like, or that one when it goes like, un, dos, tres, cuatro, and I'm like, what? No.
All right. But if you were making up their greatest hits, that might come in 27th.
But I just, I can't get into them, and I don't, like, I've tried so much because everyone says they're so nice, they're so great, they're great people, but they could be saints, but they're just not singers for me.
You know, I don't remember people hating on U2 until within the past couple years.
Yeah.
And then once it took hold.
Well, that was about that time, right? It was like the Vertigo, Beautiful Day time, I think, that people were like, don't want Beautiful Day. Like, something about, I think Beautiful Day got people really mad.
Patrick, Sandog.
Yes, Chris Stanley, did you just pick on Dave Matthews for singing about ants and fishing the whole song about a weasel?
He's right, Chris.
Fish is much better than Dave Matthews Band.
Got you.
Trinastagio's 10 times the musician that Dave Matthews is.
And yet he's not.
He plays a vacuum.
Exactly. The man can do anything.
Nate, Minnesota.
The band that I can't stand is The Offspring.
You know, I didn't like The Offspring either, but it wasn't as deep of a hatred than the way I felt about a band like Creed. But The Offspring was one of those bands who they were in a subgenre that I liked, and then they got popular, and I didn't understand why.
Right.
So I felt like there were other people who were doing that pop punk song. And then plus the vocals were forced and stuff like that.
And he seemed like the kind of guy that you wouldn't like in real life. Like, he seemed like the kind of guy who would fucking be mean to, you know, the out fucking kids, you know? He almost comes across as a bully.
He is a little bullyish, but yeah, I mean, I think his vocals were kind of irritating, but I think that's my beef with it, was I was like, why of all the pop punk bands,
Is that your favorite band, or you join Gail in hating them?
I never hated The Offspring.
Here's Steve in Bama.
Hey, before I name mine, I think a lot of it has to do with just association, like, associations with the fans, like the Grateful Dead. A lot of people hate the Grateful Dead. I think it has to do more with, like, the way their fans act than...
I would agree with that 100%.
...and the music.
Because, a lot of people who hate Dave Matthews, it's because their fans only listen to Dave Matthews, you know? So you tend to hate the bands that have the obsessive fans.
I think that's where... what happens with Fish, honestly. I think people don't like the Fish scene, but they couldn't tell you one song or anything about the band other than they don't like the Fish heads.
Pearl Jam has picked that up, and they weren't like that for years, and now people are like, oh, Pearl Jam, sorry, I don't want to drop out of society. All right, so who do you hate, Steve?
Train.
Train.
They only had that really that one hit song, though, didn't they?
Which one?
Yeah. The Drops of Jupiter?
No. Way bigger than that is Hey Soul Sister.
Oh, I forgot that that was them. No. Yeah, okay.
Now, you have to admit, the guy has an amazing voice, though. You know?
He doesn't have a bad voice.
Something about these songs, though.
And both this and the Drops of Jupiter song, very reused. I mean, that's part of what tends to get people angry, is the celebrity, but also, why am I still listening to this?
Here is Chris Phoenix.
Hey, I can't stand Green Day. I mean, I hate them so much that I cuss. I mean, I just scream at the radio every time they come on.
Now, why? What turned you off so bad?
First of all, I think their music kind of sucks. It's a lot of, like, trendy bullshit, but it's, like, their political agenda. It's not that they have their own agenda. It's the fact that they have to preach it constantly. You know, they have to be, you know, I don't know, man. Like, there's nothing wrong with it, but Green Day, I don't know what it is, man. I think their music sucks.
I think it's only the one album that they ever even get political on, right?
Yeah, and
it's just their out. I mean, it's past that. It's just when they do interviews, a lot of times they want to stand up and do all this stuff, and like I said, that's their own right, but it's just, like, coupled with their shitty music, it's horrible.
Isn't that interesting that people just despise musicians if they take any stance on anything, whether they agree or not? I mean, even the U2 thing being brought up, like, oh, you're doing charitable things. Like, it's worse to do something like that or care about something than to not. But then if they didn't, they would be vapid and stupid.
Right,
and
but you think, in their case, feeding people in Africa would be seen as a good thing.
Sure.
But it's not. It's not. Like, pisses people off.
Oh, you think you're so great.
Now, now, Green Day, as far as you're talking about their music, I can't imagine a decade that those songs wouldn't be hits. I mean, that's English Invasion.
Yeah.
You know, more than it is punk, they fit in with some kind of a Kinks situation.
Yeah, all that pop punk stuff is, like, it has that key to being, like, hard but not too hard.
Right.
And that kind of gang vocal sound.
Good Charlotte also is another one that is a little overrated, and they suck big time.
All right, here is Devin in Minnesota.
Yeah, I can't stand Kiss.
Now, tell us what your Kiss problem is.
Well, I just hate the way that they sell out. They're just changing to...
My God, all they ever did was sell out.
Well, you're right. I mean, oh, disco's popular. Let's make a disco album. Oh, people are dying. Let's make coffins. Come on. I just hate everything about that.
So you hate their marketing arm. Because you...
It's okay, and I thought about it more while I was being on hold. I hate their fans. You know how, okay, being from Minnesota, you guys, I mean, the Packers rival.
Yeah.
I don't mind the Packers. I hate the Packers fans. They never let it go, you know? And that's kind of like Kiss fans. Same thing.
I will tell you that Kiss was up here one day doing a town hall in full makeup, and this place was going fucking bananas.
Yeah.
Everybody that you would not expect to be Kiss fans was next to themselves excited.
But I also think there are so many people who they don't really know much about Kiss, but because they're so recognizable, like that makeup was the best marketing thing for them, because your grandmother will be able to say, oh, that's Kiss, you know?
Yeah, they were always a very ambitious band off stage. Like, what do we have to do? You know what I mean?
Rip.
To get this out, because they never got a real lot of radio play, you know. But it's 40 years now that they've been gigantic.
Yeah.
But this is another thing that's annoying. When I had Paul Stanley on the show, he was explaining that he wants Kiss to go out even after they're retired, and they want to own the name and send the Kiss concerts out without them. And that's...
That's a brand, then.
That's a strange thing, yeah. Jake, Jacksonville.
Hey, the Counting Crows are absolutely horrid. They're still out there. I saw him on Palladia last week at some shitty 80s festival over in Europe, and he still hasn't washed that shitty hair of his, singing the same song. It's horrible. Absolutely horrible.
You can't wash them.
Yeah, you can't wash dreadlocks, but the...
For 20 years?
Huh?
For 20 years?
Yeah, you can't wash dreadlocks. They're unwashable.
I guess he gets a pass.
But there's also really great musicians in that band. You know what I mean? Like, guys that could have played in, like, 1960s groups. Guys that really can handle themselves. But people do not like that guy because he's dated a lot as well. Pat, Stillwater. You know, a rising band.
In the harsh face of stardom.
I guess you on your better days, you are Pat from Stillwater.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
For some reason, I've never been able to explain it. Stevie next to me is just, it's nailed on a chalkboard, and I can't stomach it. And then the flip side of that, the funniest thing I've ever seen on Saturday Night Live was back in the 90s, Lucy Lawless did a thing where Stevie Nicks had a Tex-Mex restaurant, and it is the funniest shit I have ever seen in my entire life.
That's, first of all, it's already funny, Stevie Nicks' Tex-Mex food.
I'm going to respect that that's your opinion, but you're also incorrect.
I wish that she wore more gowns and had more scarves.
Oh, yeah. The lace. Yeah. Flowing lace. Alone.
We have comedian and actress Angela Johnson coming in studio. Angela's new special, Not Fancy, is available now on Netflix. Angela's performing at Levity Live in West Nyack, New York, Friday, November 6th through Sunday, November 8th. And Angela's album, Gold Play Dreams, is available on iTunes. Go to levitylive.com for tickets to the show this weekend.
Let's bring in, I guess, we got a song? Welcome, Angela. How are you?
I'm good. Thanks for having me.
You know, our phones are already blown up from a conversation that started. Is there a band that you just can't stand? I'm surprised how many people absolutely hate some bands.
I'm surprised at that, too. Everybody loves to hate Nickelback.
Yeah, like they despise Nickelback.
And I don't know why, though. Yeah. Like, who started that campaign, and then how did everybody hear
about
it?
Do you know, Gail? Do you know?
I think it's, like I was saying before, I think it happens when a band becomes so huge, it's
everybody
easier
just wants
to hate them.
Right.
Because you just keep thinking, why this band over whatever band you love, you know?
I guess so, but everybody jumped on that one.
Yeah.
I don't even know a lot of their music to jump on it, but I feel like because everybody jumped on it, and I don't want to jump on
no,
it.
No, you're right? The other way.
Like, I bought their poster yesterday. I hung it up.
Chris, you're the Nickelback age group, right?
Oh, yeah.
Were you pro or negative Nickelback?
At the time, I liked Nickelback.
Really?
Right.
I jumped into it. I was all over it.
Here's what I think happened with Nickelback is that they were playing like a grunge sound that and not being from Seattle and playing like a, so there were people felt like, okay, you've just taken this sound and you're using it to your own, or is like we could say, like we've done with all black music since the beginning of time,
right? Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like it all comes from someplace.
Yeah, it was,
you know?
Certainly a more watered down version. It was like that kind of mall rock scene.
Mall rock, that's funny.
That's perfect. Yeah.
That's hilarious. You can see it at, listen to it at Express when you're shopping. Yeah, that's great.
Faux edginess.
Is there still a mall kind of society? Is it, because I know malls are kind of dying out somewhere.
Well,
places.
In California, yeah. At least, yes. All over the country, traveling all over.
Yeah.
Usually, wherever comedy club I'm at happens to be right near a mall.
Right.
And so, like, there's still your mall walkers. My Nino, he's like in his 80s. He still gets his exercise at the mall. Like, there's still those people.
Right.
Is that the community you mean?
Yeah, I mean, like, people who just show up at the mall and that's part of their life. You know, because I know some of the malls are going bankrupt and stuff like that.
Yeah, especially with online shopping and stuff. But there's a mall in L.A. that I would love to go to, even if I didn't need to get anything. I would just go there, and I would get my Godiva chocolate because I'm part of their monthly club, and you get a free chocolate once a month. So anything that's free, I'm all about it. So I'm like, oh, I got to go get my Godiva this month. And then I'll just, like, get an iced tea and walk through and pretend I'm going to buy stuff and then go home.
I wonder if that was, it's even a thing that young people congregate in malls anymore.
Yeah.
Like, that I don't know.
When we were younger, that was
a
big thing.
What else would you do, it
right.
seems like. But
now they just congregate online. Let's do the meetup or whatever on Facebook chat group, or I don't know. I just made that up. But
it is weird, though, that I guess you don't care if you have to come home early, like when you're a kid, because you can get online and still be with your friends.
Yeah. Right.
But I remember when I was little enough that I had like a curfew, I'd be like, well, this is crushing. I'm leaving my friends. I'm leaving anyone who cares about the things I care about. But now kids could just wake up at any time, middle of the night, just start talking.
Yeah. That's true. That is true. I don't know. When in my day it was, we had to come home at a certain time and then we'd break the curfew and then we'd get grounded even longer. And then you just sneak out and then you get on the phone, but you have to take turns on the phone. My sister would have a turn and then I would have a turn. And then call waiting was invented. Hold up. Call waiting.
Yeah.
These kids don't know. They don't know the struggle. Please.
I think my parents still have a phone that has a busy signal. Like, you can call them. And it's like the last busy signal in the world.
Me and my friends are really big into the, like, three-way calling. Like, you'd get three of you on the phone.
Right. Because that was
a new thing.
Right.
It was very exciting.
Did you guys ever have out here, are you guys New York-based or East Coast?
Well, we're East Coast people.
So, did you ever have the party line? Where you could call in.
And there would be a bunch of people in the same thing. That was right before AOL hit big.
Yes. Yeah.
So, like, right then. And they used to sell that on TV, remember?
So it was like a group chat?
Yeah, it was like a group, and it would be people calling to just be in a chat. Literally, it was a chat room before there were chat rooms.
And then there was different, like, rooms from that. Like, first you would try to call, and it'd be busy signal. And then if you got in, then it was like, ooh, I got in. Like, that was the thing. It would ring. And then you enter this chat, and then you change your voice to your sexiest voice that you have. And you're like, hey, who called in? Hey, whatever. And then if you heard somebody's voice that you wanted to talk to in a private chat, then you go, hey, Joe, press 2. And then you press 2 and go to the 2 chat room. Like,
wow, that's way deeper than I even knew that it got. Yeah.
Yeah.
But you made me remember the commercials that used to be these beautiful girls that'd be like, please call. We're all hanging out here together.
I think that's a different hotline.
No, there were even ones for like kids too.
Really?
Like they used to run those in Florida where they would just have these young kids like, we're having so much fun. And I think they were all really trying to do an MTV kid look. There was a time where the only thing that people tried to do was bring MTV into something else.
Mm.
You know, like Miami Vice was MTV plus cops.
Right.
You know? They always wanted to MTV something up.
It was the beginning of that kind of youth and in your face culture where everything wanted that. All like commercials started to be like that.
Right.
Energy drinks and all that stuff. I think all of that came from MTV being like a force with young people.
You know, energy drinks is something I thought would never last. It's so funny that you say that because when it came out, I'm like, this can't be good for anyone. And they're going, you know, this will be a place that the government jumps in and stops it. And now it's just getting higher and higher and higher.
Every celebrity has one that they're endorsed by or they endorse or whatever it is. There's so many now.
But, you know, even before energy drinks, I remember if you would watch any cartoons or commercials aimed at kids, sugary cereals was always like, pow, bang, eat the cereal. You're like, we should have seen the energy drink craze coming.
Right. There should be an energy drink Lucky Charms. And just use the Lucky Charms. Whatever what was in that jammed us up when we were eating Lucky Charms. Just put it in a drink.
Well, they'll start to have those for toddlers where there's just to be a little pacifier that the kids can get caffeinated on.
Or opposite way, knock out, put a little rum on it.
Why don't we have anything like that? Why isn't there an unenergy drink because there's so many people I know who are anxious all the time.
There is one that I heard of a few years ago, and I wish I could remember the name of it, but it's something like something cow or slow cow or something like
I've never heard of
and
this.
And it is an anti-energy drink, and I was amazed by it. And of course I bought it, of course. It is slow cow.
Slow cow.
Oh, that's funny.
And it's low cow.
So they say, you know, take this if you have like a little trouble sleeping or relaxing or you're anxious. And I've never bought any of those energy drinks. I've never bought those little 4-hour energy. I never tried any of that, but I saw that and I was like, I could use a little slow cow.
Like melatonin just, in liquid form.
Just chill out, get a couple slow cows tonight.
I just saw a drink in Whole Foods. It was, you know, they do samples right at the end, and then I bought two of them. And I think it was called Chill. And it was like when you're feeling stressed and you just need to relax or whatever, like when you, you're getting ready to go to sleep, you take one of these drinks, right? And so there was like the berry one and the gingerade one. I was like, all right, I'm gonna get two of these. And then each day I got home, my husband, just chill, my husband was drinking it when I got in the middle of the day. In the middle of the day. And I was like, you don't even know what those are for. I purposely got suckered into buying them so I could try them. And he's like, whoa, it's just in there, right? That was day one. I come back the next day, he drank the other one. I was like, you gotta be kidding me.
He's just using it as a beverage.
Yeah, because it had some fizz to it.
Right. He's behind the wheel, just, I guess, just chill. The best thing for me.
How many chills have you had? What?
Yeah. Yep.
Angel Johnson's in studio. Angel's special, Not Fancy, is available now on Netflix, and she's performing at Levity Live in West Nyack, New York, Friday, November 6th through Sunday, November 8th. Go to levitylive.com for tickets. And Bonquiqui's album, Gold Play Dreams, is available on iTunes.
Chris, that was really good.
Yeah. Thank you.
That really sounded professional.
Thank you very much.
You waited till we took a breath and just jumped in with it. That's
Turned around. I was like, where is that coming from?
I know.
Oh, my God.
It was, I thought it was planned. I was like, wow, they got a system here. I almost messed it up and said another word.
I know. I want that to be the new system. See, whenever you can catch us in a natural pause, natural pause.
All right.
And then you slip it right in, and it'll be like music.
Ninja, plug ninja. That's what they call me.
Levity Live is, well, these are doing well over the country now, too, right? Levity Live.
This is my first time.
Yeah, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
I know the club is gorgeous.
That's what I hear. Everybody keeps telling me. It's really pretty. I hope people come to see me so it's not a gorgeous club with just me and my opener in it.
People are going to come see you wherever you go. What are you talking about?
You know what? It's so crazy. I mean, you know this. In stand-up, it's like some markets you're hot, and then the other markets, like, cricket, cricket, hello, hey.
Yeah.
And I have to go back to my introductory material of, my name is Angela, and like all that kind of stuff, because nobody knows who I am. I'm finding it's the Northeast that is really slow to jump on board of my ship as I'm sailing out. But like the South, the West Coast, they're all like Team Angela. And then when I come here to Pittsburgh, they're like, guess what? You sold 16 tickets.
Is that right?
Yeah, it's crazy.
So now, are you doing anything different in the other markets than you're doing in the Northeast? Yeah.
Not at all. Yeah. I do the same thing. I mean, I Instagram, I Twitter, the same stuff, but it just happens to be the people who follow me and respond to me are in the South and the West Coast. And then once I start heading up north, then it's tricky territory.
Is there a cultural difference, though, do you think?
I think this is what I found. Like, the Pittsburgh, the Philly, like the working class towns aren't about, like, I think they enjoy maybe, and this is me generalizing,
because
there's so many different people, but like more of a harsher, brass, tough, edgy comic who brings that kind of material, because that's just like the old stereotypical New York versus Hollywood. It's very like, oh, is this gluten-free? Is it, you know, is there dairy in this? And then over here, it's like people think New Yorkers are rude or whatever it is. It's like a harsher and then more soft, I think. So that's the only cultural thing that I've been able to identify. Like, maybe just people of the Northeast identify more with somebody who's more, like, tough.
Yeah, I think there is a thing of Northeast where they want you to win them over. Like, they almost want to dislike you at first and then like you a lot.
Because I would even say that's the local, like, New York comics are the same way.
Right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I don't necessarily think it's people coming from other places.
Right.
You know, it's like, I think that the crowd does do that thing where everybody has to be won over, even the locals, you know?
Yeah.
And I noticed that the New York comics are all much more aggressive with each other. So if I'll have different comics on here, sometimes a West Coast guy can get his feelings hurt by some of the New York guys. And I go, no, that means that they like you. They're just having fun.
They would probably ignore you.
Yeah, they're like, but they're going, but it doesn't feel that way. You're saying a lot of mean things right now.
They're pulling your pigtails. They're busting your balls because they like you.
If you see the way, like, Jim Norton is with, you know, his friends when they all get together, you're like, these guys must hate each other. And it's just their ability to actually say, I love you so much and I care about you.
Yeah,
it hurts
me.
Terrible, just horrific things.
Yeah.
But it is funny, but, yeah, I guess, you know, the West Coast doesn't feel that way. Although are you from Oakland originally?
I'm from San Jose, Bay Area. Okay.
Because Oakland is a rough town. That's a blue-collar town.
Yeah, and you know what's funny? There's a lot of pieces to my act, my material, where I'm, you know, this tough girl where I say I will cut you and all this kind of stuff, and I have this edginess to me. But I think it's just an overall sweetness that is just very like, oh, who's this chick? It's exactly what you said. In the East, in the Northeast, they want you to win them over.
Yeah.
And then maybe in more low, chill, Cali, whatever. It's like, hey, we're here to have a good time. All right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's that kind of vibe.
Well, there's that thing when Bill Burr was in Philadelphia and the people were booing him and he started ripping the city of Philadelphia and they were crazy about him. And he said, you know, I mean, there's over a million views on this. And he said all these really aggressive things about Philly and they just started going nuts. They were loving it.
Yeah.
And again, what is the...
And I'm sure he did not know it was going to go in that direction.
I'm not going down like this. I'm going to get even with people.
But because he was slugging back, they're like, actually, we love this dude.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's legendary in Philly because of that.
Right.
Yeah. He's beloved there for that.
It's the strangest thing in the world.
I was listening to... Oh, did you find it?
Yeah, see?
Oh, because my back is to you. That's what it is.
Yeah.
Because my back is to you. That's okay.
Angela Johnson's in studio. Angela's special, Not Fancy, is available now on Netflix, and she's performing at Levity Live in West Nyack, New York, this Friday, November 6th through Sunday, November 8th. Go to levitylive.com for tickets and Bon Quiqui's album, Gold Plated Dreams, available on iTunes.
God, Angela, before he rudely interrupted us.
With your plugs. Sorry.
I know. Rudely interrupting. Sell tickets to my show. I was listening to Kevin Hart interview where he was talking about Philly fans being the toughest, where he's from. And he's like, I remember seeing Philly fans boo Santa Claus.
Yeah.
He's like, how are you going to boo Santa Claus? You know? And it's just, I don't know.
Well, my uncle, because I'm from that area, and that came up before, and my uncle actually said, he was the skinniest Santa Claus I ever saw in my life. And I'm like, you're just now, you know, coming up with something.
But there
was a friend of mine played on the Phillies, and he was having an off season. And his kid got booed at the father and son game. And his kid was like 4 years old.
Oh,
when he was announced to go up,
he
got booed there. There was also in Philly an Easter egg hunt at the ball game for kids that were like handicapped kids. And the kids that couldn't find the eggs got booed. They're really, they love to boo there. They enjoy booing.
That's how they get their strength and energy.
I guess so.
But that Santa Claus not only got booed, he got hit with snowballs from everywhere.
Yeah.
Now, you're dressed a little warmer here today. Is this cold for you from...
I didn't know what to prepare for coming here, but I'm always cold. And then walking in between the buildings, if I walk into a shadow for a second, I'm like, dang it, I forgot my jacket. And then I step out of it. I'm like, oh, it's nice.
Because this is like the warmest November that I could ever even remember us having,
That's what I thought. I thought I was expecting cold weather, and it's been beautiful, and everybody's been saying, oh, you came, it's beautiful weather this week, and, you know, so that's good.
Because we can get some ugly. I mean, when it's really nasty in New York, it can get pretty depressing.
And it's pretty sad when it happens in November, because then you're we're doing this already.
Yeah.
And you know you've got 5 more months of it.
Oh, just even hearing that is a hideous thought, isn't it?
Terrible.
Angela Johnson's in studio.
Yeah.
Her special, Not Fancy. You can view it now on Netflix. Go to Netflix.com. Angela's performing at Levity Live in West Nyack, New York. That's tomorrow, Friday, November 6th through Sunday, November 8th. Go to LevityLive.com for tickets and go to iTunes to go to purchase Bon Quiqui's album, Gold Plated Dreams.
Now, do you always take your opener out on the road with you?
I have a few different guys that I use, usually depending on what part of the country that I'm in.
Uh-huh.
I'll take my East Coast guys, my, you know, Texas guys or whatever. But, my new special just came out on Netflix and I hadn't written enough new material before it aired.
Right.
And, is because right after I filmed it, I ended up doing this tour as my character Bon Quiqui. So it was like stand up took the back seat for a second, and then I developed this music tour. And then as soon as the music tour ended, then Netflix came out, and I'm like, crap, I don't have new material yeah. yet from the special. So I brought one of my guys with me for the rest of my dates for the rest of the year, who really he's such a good writer. He's he challenges me to write a lot, and if I'm struggling on stage with I just can't get it right, he knows my voice and he'll be able to, why don't you try it this way, try it that way. So I bring him specifically to help me grow and help me write new material so I don't get stuck in the same like patterns, you know.
Right.
So I'm bringing this guy, his name is Mal Hall, super funny, so I've brought him with me for the rest of the dates because he's just really funny.
Comedy is so funny that it's the only art form that you get rid of your best stuff, you know what I mean? Like yeah, no yeah. band would ever consider, all right, no one wants to hear your hit, so
yeah.
write a new album
yes.
of hits, by the way, new
yeah.
hits
yeah.
yeah, because you can't float, you know. But you know, I was talking to Brian Regan about this. I'm like, you have to now follow Brian Regan's best specials,
yeah.
you know what I mean? So not only do you have to go out there and be funny, but people think, oh well, he did three phenomenal specials, this one can't be good. You know what I mean?
Right.
They
yeah.
want it to be the best thing they've
yeah.
ever heard.
Yeah. It's tough. It's a lot of pressure. And I
yeah.
think in the beginning for me, because early on in my career, I had this video come out on YouTube, this nail salon joke, and it just blew up. And it was kind of scary to write new material because I was like, well, how am I going to top my own joke?
Yeah.
You know? And it was everywhere I would go, people just wanted to hear this joke. So I had to do it. And, it took me a while to get past that and to just be like, well, you know what? I'm going to fail sometimes, and I will only succeed after I've failed a few times. Like, you can't just win, 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 win. You have to have some failures so you learn from that, and that's how you make your success from all the failures. And I think once I finally just took that in and was like, hey, there's going to be some rough shows with some rough jokes where I'm just going to have to say something, be like, sorry about that, guys, still working on it, you know, whatever it is. And that's just going to be what it is. And thankfully, I got past that hump and was able to do, you know, more jokes.
Well, that's something like they never teach us in school to, oh, fail, fail, fail until you get it. Because if you think of like, if you're doing anything and you get like three F's before you get a C and then an A, those
yeah.
F's still count.
Yeah.
But the
yeah.
reality, everything should go out the door because now you've mastered this new thing.
But it's one of those things that I think it's a general lesson that people say, but then when it's happening, like, for example,
yeah.
no teacher or school is going to say, like, you're failing a lot,
yeah.
but just keep at your studies.
yeah.
Like, they're like, this is a problem. But it's one of those general things that you tell people, like, yeah, you're going to fall flat on your face, but you're going to pick yourself back up.
Yeah.
It's a lot easier to think of that.
Failing doesn't feel good.
No.
Nobody wants to do it. Who wants to fail? Who
yeah.
aims like, yeah, can't wait till I fail because that means I'm going to get back up? No. Everybody dreams of
yeah.
just being at the top, but nobody dreams of the process to get there.
Yeah, especially failing in front of people is about as close
yeah.
to the drowning feeling that you
yeah.
could possibly get.
Yeah.
Where you just, what can I possibly grab? You
oh,
know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's rough.
Yeah.
It's so funny.
But that's the problem, I guess, with doing specials. You know, I was talking to someone about this the other day. In the old days, you would get an act like vaudeville, pre-TV, and that would be the act the rest of your life.
Mm.
You would honestly do that as long as you were willing to travel to town, that 15 minutes or 20 minutes, is all anyone ever needed. Wow. And it wasn't until TV that anyone ever thought we need something new. Wow. You know?
Wow.
Never.
Yeah. That is such a good point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a really, really new thing of expecting comedians to put out even a special year. I mean, even for years, it was only Carlin that was really putting out a massive amount of stuff like that.
Yeah, it seemed like older comedians had, what, like one or two like albums that people knew about, maybe one other. Yeah. But you're right, it is constant now.
Well, it's Jay Leno, even in the old days, never would do it. There's never any HBO specials because he goes, why would I give away my material no matter what it was for?
What do you think set the bar for that with comedians producing specials so quickly now, like one
a
year?
I think because we got so many new TV channels where you could do comedy here, like 10 different places. For a long time, it was just HBO, you know?
Right.
Well, now between Netflix all the way up and also YouTube, where material shows up, whether people want it to or not, sometimes. You know?
I think it's the age that we're in with social media.
Yeah.
And I mean, now there's Vine stars that don't have an act, but they're creative on Vine.
Right.
And they're Vine celebrities. And so now they can sell tickets to a show and what you can come see them live in person. I don't know what they do live in person, but there's, and that's not to crap on Vine stars. I have many friends who are Vine stars, you know, but it's there's so many different mediums now. Now there's TV, but now there's TV. Now there's Instagram. Now there's Vine. Now there's Snapchat. Now there's all these different social media things that you can be a part of and use to your advantage, or somebody puts your material out there whether you wanted it or not.
Right. Chris was just mentioned yesterday by who, Chris?
Vice Magazine.
For being what?
A budding Periscope star.
Oh,
yeah, that's right, Angela. Yeah, yeah. I got something to plug too.
Yeah, he's
a- look at you. I'm gonna have to follow you on Periscope.
Now, where do you hope to take that, Chris?
I'm trying to just build more shows. I already have three or four. And I'm just trying to have a repertoire of Periscope shows that I can give out to my Scope bros.
But you
those
said,
are my fans, Angela.
Yeah, he's coined the term Scope bros, is why they love him.
Yeah.
But. I don't see this going anywhere for you.
What? The sky's the limit. Heart's the limit.
The mere
is what
fact
I like to
that
say.
You call them shows.
Yeah. Now, one of the shows I saw you eat 30 hamburgers at 4 o'clock in the morning.
That was Crave Case.
A Crave Case from where?
White Castle.
He bought 30 hamburgers by himself.
Suitcase of cheeseburgers.
And it was what time in the morning, by the
way? It was 4:45 in the morning or something.
Why?
well, the bar's closed, so I had to go someplace.
Oh. So it's a health nut. You know what I mean?
Well, the name of that
tips to everybody.
The name of that show is White Castle is Good for You with Chris.
So I was actually watching it in the middle of the night, and I was going like this: please don't choke, please don't choke. I won't be able to get there in time.
But you were actually watching it then.
Yeah, because my phone went off to his thing, and like it's like an alarm now. Like, oh, Chris is on. Let's see what he's doing.
See? It's a show.
Yeah, and there were hundreds of people at 4:30 in the morning.
All live. All loving it. Yeah. Talking to me. I was talking back. You know, I was reading their comments. Those are the Scope bros.
Have you ever gone on to the map on Periscope and tuned in to some random person in Indonesia
love
doing
it.
Periscope?
Yeah. Love doing that.
It's so fun.
It's very
it's
addicting,
amazing.
Too.
Yeah.
Like, I get very addicted to just clicking around and finding weird things.
I get addicted, but then I get scared. I'm so stupid. I think everybody's trying to attack me. I watch too many episodes of Criminal Minds, Law and Order, all that kind of crazy stuff. And so I'm like, ooh, I want to leave a comment like, hey, Russia from Los Angeles. And then they see my name, and then they Google me, and then they come find me. And I'm like, oh, my God, I just, like, infiltrated ISIS somewhere.
I know.
And, like, now they're going to find me. So I tune in, but then you know how it tells you, oh, so-and-so joined the conversation. Even that scares me. I'm like, oh, they just saw I joined.
But, yeah, I'll check out a Middle East thing, too, and I'll think, how do I won't understand them.
Yeah.
And then I'll go, how do I know this isn't a recruitment?
Yeah.
And that they're going to think that I'm somehow tied in with ISIS. Because ISIS is on Twitter, right?
Oh, they're huge on social media. That's what they're all about.
Yeah.
That is insane.
I know.
They have a brand.
Yeah.
But they refer to the ISIS brand.
Oh, my gosh. They're going to come out with their new energy drink. Yeah. It's going to be great.
Yeah, they sold out. You know, they used to be so cool.
Really sold out.
Used to really like them back in the early days.
And they were really choosy about who was in the group.
Yeah, now everybody. Anybody with the money is in it. But I watched even, I watched some of the China stuff and...
I like Russia also.
Russia's great.
You know you do.
But a lot of those kids in Russia will just put their phones up while they're in school.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Really?
And, yeah. And they act as bad in school as American kids. They're, I would have thought to myself, Russia, there's a really strict school. No, doesn't look that way at all.
Not any different.
No, no different at all. And kids are listening to Drake. I don't know why, but anywhere in the world, they're listening to Drake.
Wow.
Yeah.
Angela Johnson's in the studio.
Yeah.
Angela's special, Not Fancy, is available now on Netflix. She's performing at Levity Live in West Nyack, New York, Friday, November 6th through Sunday, November 8th. On Twitter, it's at Angela Johnson. That's Angela with a J. And Bonquiqui's album, Gold Play Dreams, is available on iTunes. And to get tickets to the Levity Live show, go to levitylive.com.
Angela, thanks so much for stopping in.
Thanks for having me. This was fun.
Yeah. We'll see you next time coming through.
All right. Thank you.
About that you.
Oh. I kind of hate the way I'm Hicks's backup singer there.
Yeah. It's his world.
When I come in, it's kind of exciting, you know?
Yeah, and then I never realized I ever said shoot that juice out, but I guess I did. Doesn't seem like something I would say. I think that was faked.
You just said it.
Don't isolate that, please.
I would be honest here. I think that you say that a lot.
More than I realized.
Shit that juice. That's why I won't go to a juice bar with you. Because you'll just yell that out.
I don't care where I am. I'll say it.
Rob claims he has a spy report.
Spy report.
Yes, Rob.
I definitely saw the new Ghostbusters poster, and it's awesome. And I'm 100% sure that's Chris Stanley in the poster.
Dude, if you go from Vice to being on Ghostbusters when it's locked in, I mean, you only had one line. It's not going to help you too much in your career. I don't even remember what your line was, do you?
It was, go, go, Ghostbusters!
As they were running by.
Yeah, I was like a construction worker.
Is that what you were?
Yeah. And then I was like, they gave me a chance to ad-lib a line, so I went with, go, go, Ghostbusters!
Why did you do that?
Because I thought it would be fun. Like, I'm like a New Yorker. I'm a native New Yorker, and I'm telling the Ghostbusters to go do it. Go, go, Ghostbusters!
Now, you're a native New Yorker, right?
Yes, I am.
You live here. Why would you think you had to do something different with your accent then?
I thought that's what people expect New Yorkers to sound like, so I was like, I'm going to give them what they want.
Really?
Go,
make it
go,
real.
Ghostbusters!
Really make it realistic.
Yeah, I guess.
Hyper real is what I like to call hyper realism.
No. I don't know. Yeah, what's a big story out there today that's piqued your interest?
Well, tell you what piqued my interest. was a little conversation, a little interview that happened with Marco Rubio, in which he was asked by his interviewer, if you could share a beer with anybody on Earth outside of the political world,
yeah,
who would it be? And Marco Rubio responds that he would love to share a beer with Malala. Malala, the activist, underage, Muslim female. I don't think that there could be a worse answer to say.
All right, let's take a look at Malala. I want to see her, what her picture looks like there.
She's a she's an activist. Mm-hmm. She's a feminist. She was there's Malala. I think she's like 17, 18 years old.
No.
She was also, you know, a victim of an assassination attempt. Right.
And if she drank beer as a Muslim in her country, they probably would have hit her with sticks until she died.
Exactly. And also, if she, let's say, wasn't a Muslim, she still would be an underage girl in our country, in our land. So no matter what, I think that that could not have been a weirder answer. Other than just saying like an underage sex symbol or something, maybe would have been the the only thing he could have said weirder.
Now, here's the thing too. I understand that we're not going to get a Ben Carson and we're not going to get a Don Trump. They're both going to drop out. And people are telling me it looks really good that it's going to be Marco Rubio. And I'm like, what are you kidding me?
Marco Rubio is an actual imbecile, I think.
No.
I think he's actually maybe an idiot.
I like that song, though. Marco Rubio. Oh.
Well, that makes me like him a little more.
Yeah. He's a Florida guy, right?
He is a Florida guy, yeah. And so, he was the one who was so thirsty when he was doing that. Do you remember that thing? He kept reaching for the water and yeah. going like this.
Not used to all this.
That man can't be president.
Seems like he's a lock.
He has such hydration issues. He's so uncomfortable.
It's just, to me, going to be so depressing if we get him instead of Donald Trump after all the Donald Trump fun.
Oh, this would be way worse of a situation. I would much rather deal with Trump. Because that's like an enemy, I think, even if you don't like Trump, it's something people could get behind.
Hey, keep you interested. It'll be fun.
Oh, yeah. Everyone's going to be.
Turn on the TV and everybody's, you know, talking like, what are we doing with Trump?
Yes. It's going to be a love him, leave him kind of thing.
Yeah.
There's going to be crazy people like, I, for one, like Donald Trump.
I'll be that guy.
Sure.
I'll just be yelling out Donald Trump. Ben Carson, I can't get behind at all. But I would at least prefer him to this Marco Rubio.
Oh, no. No, the Marco Rubio would be the worst.
I'd rather have Jeb Bush than Marco Rubio.
Me too. Me too.
I'd rather have Huckabee than Marco Rubio. Trying to get a little finally. Yeah. Finally, the ice cracking.
I like Trump because he pranked Marco Rubio not too long ago where he sent him a bunch of towels, Trump towels, and a bunch of Trump spring water.
Oh, because he sweats like a pig?
Yeah, all the time. Said, hope this helps, Marco.
He could end up winning the sweating vote, though.
Oh, yeah. True. So that's Chris and some of his friends and contemporaries.
I'll take that goddamn vote all the way to the house.
I've known in my life.
What are you talking about?
Just let him go. He's on a roll. He's got the whole vice thing. But
that's all he's...
I've had friends in my life, though, that have had a sweating problem like so bad that they have to prep things, like keep extra clothes in their car, make sure that they don't go right from the car straight into a meeting,
right?
Because they really need time to towel down and cool down.
I worked once for a sweaty boss, and he also, you know, not only was he just sweaty in life, but he also rode his bike to work. And in the summer, he would take the dress shirt off and pack it. So if you were coming in at the same time, you'd have to see your boss, like, without his blouse on.
That's just hilarious.
Just covered in glistening sweat. It was very uncomfortable for me.
Shimmering, really. Yeah. I've had a boss who was really sweaty once.
You had a sweaty boss, too?
Yeah, I mean... More than it was just noticeable, and he wouldn't change his shirt, so by like 3 p.m. he would just have pit stains down to here. Also, why wear white all the time, you know? If you're so sweaty, wear black.
Why don't you just wear whatever sweat color it is?
Just wear salt. Yellow, like yeah. Yellowy?
Yeah, a yellowy off-salt look. So that you look like nice and salted already. You just say to people, look, I'm taking this out of the package right now.
See how it looks. So before you think it's my sweat.
Don't get the...
This is pre-salted.
Everyone wants to know on Twitter why our pad data says Breitbart News Daily.
Well...
It's changed now. I changed it.
What was it before?
It was the commercial that played beforehand. Before we came back on, apparently that pad data was stuck on there, so I had to resend our good pad data.
So you don't put that pad data in it?
I don't put that pad data
in. It's automatic.
Exactly, yeah.
Automatic for the people.
And then the pad data is sometimes different for between the Sirius receivers, XM receivers, and the online app. So I like to send
the non-Sirius receivers.
Exactly, yeah.
They love to check that pad data, though. They're all on it. They're always helpful.
They like the slightest fucking mistake to attack our producers.
Producers, huh?
Mm-hmm. They produce things for the show. In Chris's case, he has a bad arm and he periscopes.
I'm a producer who loves produce.
I never saw you eat any produce before.
That was a lie.
I know you've never eaten any vegetables. I doubt you've done well with fruit.
Barely. Well, I ate that giant bowl of fruit salad when I was high. That was really the most fruit I've had in
a remember year. One day we're in a restaurant and Chris says, "What's this?" And I'm like, "It's a string bean." How do you not know what a string bean is?
I had no idea. It was like in a pot or something. I didn't know what the fuck I was looking at.
How do you eat this? You just crack the shell open? And
can it be eaten?
Is it all edible? Like, what's going on with this thing?
Is this the root part or what is this?
Or the husk. Should I husk it?
I hate a husk. It's just a weird thing.
Why?
I don't know. Just this, all that good stuff that was inside, that was gone. Now it's just a shitty husk. I also don't like the word either, husk.
That's because you always had to shop at the husky section.
Husk.
Don't tell me that you're...
Husk.
Right, here we go. Give me a little volume on this.
Pump it up.
Always you don't even need it. How about for you?
Ladies, take note.
Chris, who's your favorite?
Mr. Lindsey Buckingham.
Really?
He played for us live in studio. It was amazing.
So yours is personal.
That's right. That's right, Scope Bros.
Stevie Nicks.
Over Mick Fleetwood. You're a fucking drummer.
That's shocking to me.
You don't have any respect for Mick Fleetwood.
I do. He's a fantastic drummer.
I would have thought you would have been a Fleetwood man.
Let me tell you something. We had Mick Fleetwood on one time. He is incredibly charismatic. Incredibly charismatic.
Yeah.
He's like a wizard from a storybook.
He's awesome. Close second after Lindsey for me.
Can I guess yours?
I don't think those guys even liked each other. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm going to guess yours.
Yeah.
Christine McVie.
How did you know that, man?
Is it true?
How did you know that?
Would you have said that no matter who I said?
You got it. Whatever that shining gift is, you've got it.
Just looked at me and said, "Son, you have it. Got it." And I was like,
you know, Lindsey Buckingham's brother.
Lillian Gish was there.
Her sister.
I was.
Do, 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 do. Sean, Alabama.
Hey, Ronnie, going back to the Mick Fleetwood interview, how do you perceive other countries see our dialects? Because every time like Mick speaks, I just sit here at the wheel while I'm driving, listening to it in awe. I was wondering how the other people, you know.
Well, I think we got to come across as some real hayseeds to the English. You know what I mean? I mean, the fact that we have zero interest in poetry, and when you hear any English person start to do a poem, you're like, oh, they understand this.
This is their thing.
Yeah. Language.
Poetry is almost like a dirty word here.
Yeah.
It's poetry.
Isn't poetry, man, makes everything all right. Hi, everybody. I'm Phoebe Snow. Yeah, I think that they probably look at us like just fucking slack-jawed mouth breathers.
Yes.
I know they do. They probably come over and this is what we sound like to them. Can't get enough air.
Those poor people.
Fast food, please. Immediately. Lots of fast food.
Who drank my Just Chill?
That Just Chill thing was fun, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just find out the dude just sitting at home just trying to chill as hard as he can.
I'm going to see if there's can get my hands on a couple slow cows tonight.
Take your big slow cow and get out of here. Hi, everybody. I'm Donald Fagen. A band called Steely Dan.
Wow.
Yeah. A band that you've loved for over 40 years. This is my tiny keyboard. And these session players are my band. Ba-ba-dum. Why you keep giving me thumbs up?
Oh, because comedian Chad Daniels is here. Chad's performing at Comedy on State in Madison, Wisconsin, November 19th through the 21st. You go to madisoncomedy.com for tickets. You'll also be performing at Dr. Grin's in Grand Rapids, Michigan, December 3rd through the 5th. Go to bob.com/Dr. Grin's Comedy for tickets.
Where's your big song for him?
Here it is.
Welcome, buddy. Good to meet you.
Yeah, likewise.
Comedy on State, you know, some people call that the finest club in America.
Really?
Yeah.
I've heard some people also dislike it.
Well, there's one in particular that dislikes it. But that's all I know. Have you played there before?
I have, yeah.
And what do you think of it?
Yeah, I love it. College kids, it gets kind of crazy. It's fun.
You like playing in front of college kids?
In a club, I do, not in a college, because then it's gang mentality. I get a lot of 18-year-olds shaking their heads, and you're like, you just moved out of your parents' house. Can you not tell me how life works?
This guy.
Boo.
I'm texting boo to my friends. Not going to say it myself, though.
And I shit all over my 16-year-old son, and they're 18, so they feel offended by it.
They're going to take his side.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
I know when I was a kid, I was always on the kid's side, no matter what happened. If I would see like a kid getting in trouble, like in the mall or something, but even babies do it. If a like you're in a church and you got a baby, and another baby cries, that you're the baby that's with you will start crying too.
Yeah.
Like we're all crying now.
This is horrible.
Like Joe, when you and your brother,
yeah,
lost the Vikings game.
Yeah,
that time.
Yeah, that really hurt that time.
He and his brother cried at the exact. How old were you guys?
I was 8, and my brother was 10, and it was 1998. In the playoffs.
Oh, Denver Broncos.
Yeah. Denver Broncos.
Pulled left field goal.
Yeah.
I remember it well.
Yeah.
And you just started sobbing.
Just started sobbing. Just bawling my eyes out.
What
really
a pussy.
Hard.
No, no. It's football.
Exactly. It was not the Broncos. It was
We were playing the Atlanta Falcons in the NFC Championship.
Right.
Yeah. And we lost.
Oh, right. Broncos went to the
Broncos.
They would have played the Broncos.
Yeah.
See, I actually didn't cry, but I lived out the Super Bowl with the Vikings versus the Broncos in my mind.
That's smart.
That's what I did.
Yeah. I honestly think,
Vikings won. No big deal.
Oh, yeah.
I honestly think the Vikings would have won that.
So. We were so good that year.
Yeah.
I mean, the Vikings, I shouldn't say William.
No, wait, you're part of the team. You were 10?
Yeah.
You were a pulling guard?
I was left tackle for a little bit, but then they moved me to right tackle. And I couldn't adjust.
Because you were crying?
Yeah.
If you weren't on the team, why'd you have the jersey then? You know what I mean? You're probably
point,
on the team. They only give those to team players.
I know.
Dan just brought in some water.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
No, he won't do that when he knows the comic, though.
Oh.
Because he's a comedian himself. So if he knows the comic, he's just like, hey, dude. What's up, man?
You bring your own water? Good.
Yeah. Why didn't you bring them water? I know him, and he doesn't like water.
He says he's thirsty right now, and he's pointing at his mouth. He seems to be suffering.
He does that all the time.
Yeah, that's his thing. That's his joke thing. Chris Stanley, any new word from Vice?
Nothing new from Vice.com, but, you know, it's taking time for sell on the Periscope news.
You believe that you are going to be touring for Vice now?
Yeah, I'm pretty much a Vice correspondent now. I hope they send me to either North Africa or even South America, maybe Brazil. I'm going to some of the favelas.
We were talking about the election earlier. Here's a Martin O'Malley bit that he's running as his ad campaign. Should be up on the iBank today, right? All right, so we'll just play the top one, and this is his ad campaign, and this is from the Democratic presidential debate. So just play this a little bit.
The federal government shouldn't be involved in gun laws.
For the federal government to be having any kind of, you know, blanket rules that they're going to try to impose, I think doesn't make sense.
But, Senator, you were for that when you ran for Senate in New York.
Sound familiar?
The federal government shouldn't be involved in gun laws.
federal government blanket rules, I think doesn't make sense.
A single life in America is worth more than all the guns in the United States. How many senseless acts of violence do we have to endure as a people before we stand up to the congressional lobbyists of the National Rifle Association? How many more Americans
have to die?
Going crazy.
Crowd going crazy for him. Now they say, here's the actual thing from the Go Down One. The
click the link.
Yeah. From the Democratic Convention. This is what it actually sounded like.
Next one down.
Next one down.
Acts of violence do we have to endure as a people before we stand up to the congressional lobbyists of the National Rifle Association? How many more Americans have to die?
That's so sad.
So he just sweetened it up that big.
Yes, that's a huge difference.
Yeah.
Which it's crazy to think that's something you easily would have been able to get away with.
Right.
Before the internet.
Yes, the internet ruins everything for everybody.
But it's immediate now. Like, yeah. Immediately, there would have been a time somebody heard that and went, yeah, I don't really think that that sounded like it.
Yeah.
And it would take a long time for that word to kind of go around and people would discuss it. But now with the internet, you have an immediate comparison the second that ad came out. Somebody's like, oh, no, you don't.
Yeah.
That is not true at all. Which is not, I'm not to say that he didn't deserve, it was a nice thing that he said, but just how embarrassing.
Well, you got to have the reality of it all. You cannot add applause.
No.
You can't do it.
It also happened to be thunderous. Like, it was like he crushed it.
I have seen different people's comedy specials where you'll just hear this big applause break, and then they're dumb enough while they're doing that, they cut to the audience, and you just see people smiling.
Staring.
Yeah. I don't know. He's doing something.
I was always thinking about that when I was young with America's Funniest Home Videos.
Oh, yeah.
Because they would play a video that you know is not a good one. Like, it would be like a middle one that they would just kind of throw in there. And they would cut to somebody like losing their shit and like hitting their date. Like, this is the best. You're like, you know that's from another fucking video. Nobody laughed that hard at the kid getting hit in the nuts with a wiffle ball.
It's pretty funny though.
But yeah, well, here's the thing that's even worse than that. They actually, before the show, ask people to laugh, go crazy. They shoot that.
No. Yeah. Is that true?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
And then they tape it in where it is. But people want to be on TV so bad that they don't mind it.
Right.
You know?
I shot a half hour for a certain comedy network, and my buddy came out to see me, and then he was on someone else's special laughing. It wasn't even the same night. He wasn't even talking at that joke.
This is one of the ones great. That they shoot two in one night.
Yeah. 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 But I mean, I'm not even, he wasn't even at, not that one even. Not the one I shared it with.
Really?
Completely different special, different night. Yeah.
He was just being a good laugher.
Yeah.
Like, let's use this guy. We need to go to somebody.
One of them I just looked up and John Kennedy was laughing. I'm like, where did they get this from?
But that would really upset me if you got cut after like a really corny joke.
Yeah, right.
Or just something.
You're just screaming.
Yeah.
At Gallagher 2. Just hopping. I like, you were like, you're going off like you were a black guy who just saw a magic trick on David Blaine.
Oh, shit. What the fuck, son?
No, no.
Just running.
For black people, they see all magic as black magic. It's just evil. There is no sleight of hand for them. There's no, how did you do that? They know how you did that. The power of Satan.
Yes. They're like, David Blaine is the devil.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, he did that because he's the devil. That's how he was able to.
That's what the devil would do.
They make the same movements as when their friend is going to get in a fight when they're behind them, but it's they're excited this time.
Right. Well, they'll pull it. Oh, yeah. But David Blaine is the guy who invented doing close-up magic on the street, and it was the most brilliant idea in the history of comedy because you take any presentation out of out of magic that we've hated for years with top hats and he just walks up to people on the street and does it. And while they were smart enough to figure out how to do this, I don't know. Look, there she goes.
She's running. She's gone. But yeah, I loved those specials when they came out, those David Blaine Street Magic specials.
Well, they still run almost around the clock.
Do they?
You can see them. Now, the other thing, now, as cool as David Blaine looked at doing that, then he turned around and did all the weird stunts in New York that comes across way cheesier.
Yes, I think that killed him. Like, maybe the first one. What was the first one? The block of ice?
I think he was inside a block of ice. He was inside an aquarium for...
Some kind of box.
Yeah.
And then the grossest thing about that in the aquarium is that you're like, oh, the water's so gray. And then they said, oh, that's skin.
Oh,
it's just skin that was coming
off. Skin.
But the other one that they showed him standing up in the park, right on top of a pole.
Yeah.
And you could see that his leg was real straight because there was something going up, hooking a brace to him.
Right.
So he didn't fall off
like he's
pole.
A Lego guy or something.
Yes. Yeah. He was completely locked in. Yeah, I saw him do that one where he was just standing on a pole for a week or something like that.
Right.
And black people hate this shit. Yeah, they just want to see him bite a quarter in half.
Yeah, right. You're right. You're right. This doesn't impress them at all. They wouldn't look up to see him doing
shit,
this.
Dog. I seen a statue.
but he bites the quarter in half. Look how he's barely moving. One time he said he was going to throw himself the Brooklyn Bridge, but he couldn't pull it off.
No, they wouldn't let him.
I'm like, you got to.
No, yeah, that's better if you do it without anyone's permission. It'd be even cooler.
Then they did one in London where he just stayed in a glass box up high, and the people in London were not kind to him at all.
Well, yeah, that one is a little bit too much of a gift. Like, are you in a glass box or are you really high?
Well, those people have been living with guards that you can spit on that don't move forever. Right. They're not impressed by that shit.
I think his greatest trick ever pulled was getting the world to think he didn't actually exist.
And like that, he was gone.
He was still there. Yeah. He was still just standing there telling people about his next special. David Blaine, Vertigo.
I'd like to see him have another day. Oh. No, another day in the sun. Bring it back.
Stunt-wise?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know what this... Oh, I forgot. Remember Buried Alive, where he wasn't buried alive?
I didn't go see that one. That was in the city as well,
yeah,
right?
It was in the city, and he was down. They had him laying on the ground and then put an aquarium over him for some reason. It was a very strange one that didn't go over big.
No.
Why they put the water there, I don't know.
But then there was one where he was in water, too, right? Is that one different?
Yeah, that's the water one. That's when he was in the spear.
Yeah. That one was pretty cool. Because people would come up to him, and you could go up to the actual sphere of water.
Yeah, and then he would put his hand up to you. That's when Dave took little David Blaine up to see him. It was a very weird day for us.
He also did another one where he had like electricity shot through his body for like 36 hours.
I forgot that one.
That one was called Electrified, 1 million volts always on.
Now,
wordy.
I went to see Chris Angel hanging from meat hooks with his skin.
That was pretty cool.
And like we're sitting there looking at him, people are like, this is fake. I'm like, it looks like a dude hanging from his skin to me.
But the problem with that one is you can go on the internet and there's just people who like fetishists who just do that. Like it's not really
a
stunt. I didn't
even know that.
Yeah, that's like a thing that they're like, oh yeah, I have this meat hook fetish. I just like to hang on meat hooks.
Why?
They have those gauges put in their skin so they can use it to hook themselves
exactly.
up.
Exactly. So you gauge out
so
the skin so you can rehook in there anytime you please when you just want to hang out.
You're like Neo after he got out of the fucking Matrix. It's really weird.
Exactly.
No.
Yeah. Definitely.
All right. I already saw this get done by the cars in a video.
I think actually Joe Bluth did this one as well.
Walk on water?
Jesus did it too years ago.
He was the original guy.
Yeah. But the thing is, could Jesus go underwater? Or did it feel bad? He was just looking at his friend swim.
He could swim.
I just can't
I wish
swim.
I could, but...
He couldn't risk it crawling out of the sea. Because yeah. People like, Jesus did too.
I can swim in dirt, but you guys can't do that. Sucks.
Sad, though.
Yeah.
Hey, Bob, you're on the Bennington Show.
Bennington's first time, long time, love the show. I'm from way back in the Ron and Ron days, so
you do
I'm
go
down
back,
here. Then. I do go back. I'm down in St. Pete, and I was part of the. I was working for the contractor who did the Chris Angel explosion on Clearwater Beach a couple of years ago. We blew up the hotel, and it was all filmed on live TV. And Chris Angel was chained up to the railing. If anybody remembers,
no.
On one of the hotel rooms, and then he had to unlock all the doors and get out and escape out the back. Well, it was all pre-recorded. So basically, none of those chains or nothing existed. On TV, it looked like, you know, oh my gosh, he's, you know, got only a couple minutes and they're going to blow it up. No, it was all pre-recorded. We pre-recorded everything earlier. I saw them pre-recorded, I should say. So basically, all he had to do was unlock the chain. Or unlock how he was tied to the to the railing, and he just ran out the back door, and then there was a signal to give to the guy to, yep, go ahead and blow up the building. You know, he's clear. And then the building went down, and there's dust everywhere, and then he comes walking through like a Nicolas Cage movie, you know, where he just blows up a car and just keeps walking, you know. It was hilarious because it was all recorded. It was pre-recorded. It was all fake.
I think there's something so wonderfully corny
yeah.
about somebody who would go to that length to say illusion.
I remember when Chris Angel had a TV show, right? Like where he was doing
Mindfuck.
Exactly, yeah. Mindfuck. So it was on the program Mindfuck, where I was in college at the time, and me and a bunch of my roommates were watching the show. And I've never had this experience where a trick is happening, and I was like, I will tell you right now how this works. So his gimmick was, I cannot be pushed down by 100 men, right? So he's like, I'll stand here, and 100 men will try to push me, and I won't move an inch. But everybody's in a line, so it's, you know, 100 people, and they're all pushing at the same time. But you're only going to be pushed by the person who's in front of you. Not everybody's falling down. Everybody's literally doing the same trick you are, which is not being pushed down by the person behind them. And it's like, while it's happening, it's like the final trick of the show. You know how he leaves the big one to the end? And I'm like, I don't even need to see this to tell you how this is going to work. And then he did it, and he was like, I didn't move. And I'm like, but neither did anyone else. Everyone stayed on their pins.
And he got like millions of dollars to do that.
Yeah.
It's a clever way to trick people into training you. It's a trick, guys. Trust me.
Chad Daniels is in studio. Chad's performing at Comedy on State in Madison, Wisconsin, November 19th through the 21st. Go to madisoncomedy.com for tickets. We'll also be performing at Dr. Grin's in Grand Rapids, Michigan, December 3rd through the 5th. Go to thebob.com/Dr. Grin's Comedy. And on Twitter, it's at Chad Daniels 34.
I remember one time, and I can't think of like what year it was, but I called a magician at his hotel room. I can't remember what his name was, but he was like a guy with like one of those fucking hats. You know what I mean? It was like, it was so old school that he had like a top hat on. And like, I just thought it was amazing that a magician was in my town. I called, wasn't under a different name, put me right through. I was just like, just want to say great show. But you do. I just thought
I really appreciate your work.
When I was a little kid, I thought if you were on television, you were set and you were the same. And I don't care if you were like Paul Newman or the guys on Match Game. You were all equally great, in my opinion, and equally as famous.
I think for me, what the assumption is, anybody who's on TV must be rich.
You know, people in my hometown think that. That's real fun. You gonna pick up the tab? No, I'm sure not.
But it's hard to believe if you've watched the, you know, Tonight Show from whatever small town you grew up in, you think of that as nothing could be that big.
Right.
You know what I mean? And then you get to New York or L.A. and you see people who are going, just like leave there and walk out to their car.
Right.
It's just like, oh, so you're a person when you're on TV. You're still a human being living a life. I get it now. All right. I understand. I just thought you went into some lovely fucking space place that doesn't exist on this planet.
And you're all friends with each other. You must be friends with Jack Nicholson then, since you've been on television.
There is a weird thing, though, because I see it working here where celebrities come in and they all say hi to each other. You know what I mean?
They're like, there's a silent understanding.
Hello, celebrity, fellow celebrity. I'm a baseball player, you're a cook, but we're both celebrated for our work. I'll see them stop outside these things all the time and I'll crack up. And they'll go, do they know each other? And the handler's always like, no, they just met for the first time. And I'm like, then they were still doing a secret handshake that doesn't exist for us.
Chad Daniels is in studio. He's performing at Comedy on State in Madison, Wisconsin. It's November 19th through the 21st. On Twitter, it's at ChadDaniels34. And he'll be performing at Dr. Grin's in Grand Rapids, Michigan, December 3rd through the 5th. Go to bob.com/Dr. Grin's Comedy.
So did we never got into this Buffalo Bills hot dog debate. And apparently they had a big argument. And this is an argument that goes back a lot of years. Is the hot dog a sandwich or not? Now, if you order a hot dog and you get one at a cart right out front, do you feel like you're getting a sandwich?
No, I feel like I'm getting a hot dog. I mean, it has bread as the elements of a sandwich, but I don't feel like it's a sandwich.
You know what makes something a sandwich, though?
Vertical.
The elements of a sandwich.
It does have the elements, and yet a hot dog, I would never in a million years think of. I would never think of that as
Change
a sandwich.
It. If it was a sausage, would you call that a sandwich?
I suppose, yeah.
You don't have to suppose. You know you do.
Have you ever put ketchup on a sandwich?
Good point.
That's a really good line.
No.
Me either, and I like ketchup.
And yet, you put ketchup on a hamburger, and they used to call hamburgers hamburger sandwiches. You can see that in old movies.
Which I wish they would bring back.
Sure. But I have never thought of the premise of you don't put ketchup on a sandwich.
Yes, I don't think that there's any sandwich that it belongs on. What sandwich would, other than...
Ketchup sandwich.
But I mean, there's no...
Some people put ketchup on a cheesesteak. And is that a sandwich?
The cheesesteak is a sandwich. I don't put ketchup on a cheesesteak.
Oh, I put ketchup on a plate and dip a grilled cheese into the ketchup.
That's really strange.
Yeah, thank you. But I don't put it on any sandwiches, no.
All right, Chris.
Yes?
Hot dog is a sandwich.
It is not a sandwich. It is a something else.
A something else doesn't make sense. All right, if it's not a sandwich, if you guys ordered a hot dog and the guy just put the link up there and you didn't get any bread, you would say, I need bread. And he'd say, you just ordered a hot dog. You didn't order.
Would you like the sandwich combo?
Hot dog sandwich.
Yeah, you didn't order a hot dog and bread.
No. That would be bizarre. That would be bizarre to me. But it's not a sandwich, though. It's just an item with bread that isn't a sandwich.
It's a bizarre snack that involves bread. I don't have an answer for what.
You have bread and meat in the middle. How is that not a sandwich? And you hold it in your hand. You're not cutting it with a knife and fork.
I'm going to even say that the texture of the hot dog bun even doesn't help its case.
Well, I'm not crazy about the hot dog bun, if I'm going to be totally honest. Where I come from, you kind of get it on a hard roll.
I wish that was the standard everywhere.
It should be. And if I'm elected president, it will be. I can guarantee you that.
Here's my issue with a hot dog. You know how if you're eating a hot dog and you're hungry, like really hungry, and you have one, and it doesn't really feel like it's enough?
Mm-hmm.
But the second hot dog is not a great idea. For bun alone. That's so much of that weird spongy bun that it doesn't make sense.
I had a hot dog that I ate in, bit into, and it was so mushy. It was a boiled, gross hot dog with not the skin on. And I thought, I would say pudding.
Oh, God.
I would put it in the pudding category.
Before sandwich. That may now be a pudding. Here's Sean in Alabama.
Hey, Ronnie, it's the bun. Think about a po' boy sandwich. It's on French bread, things like that. So it's the bread that does it, not the inner.
I would agree with
that. All right, but haven't you ever eaten a hot dog on French bread or Italian bread? Because
no,
I have.
I actually eat it on bread. I fold it in half. That's what I do. I don't like bread.
Got a piece of white bread?
What are you folding in half?
Well, I put a dog in it and just fold it.
Like a piece of white bread?
Out of bread. Yeah, out of white bread, but I eat wheat, you know, to be more healthy.
I'll say this, and Chris is a lifelong Yankees fan.
That's right.
That bun up there is a piece of Wonder Bread.
Yeah, that's what they
it's
throw out there.
It's not a real bun at Yankee Stadium.
I did not know that. That's just a folded piece of bread?
Yeah, it's made specially for them, and it's Wonder Bread. Am I wrong about that?
No, it's Wonder Bread. It's Wonder Bread, but they get it for them, and then they wrap it in a hot dog.
You know, speaking of wrap,
bizarre.
There was a guy one time that wrapped his dick. Mm-hmm. He like put his balls on both sides of his dick and then wrapped it around and he said, "Why don't you come get this dick sandwich?" And there's no bread involved in that. So now what?
But that's still a sandwich.
Yeah, I don't know.
Did that guy turn out to be you?
No, I promise.
I have this friend. He's a comedian.
And here's exactly how he did it step by step.
Here, come get this dick sandwich.
Who wants a dick sandwich?
Here is, all right, there are people now going the other way against this catch-up rule that we all immediately fell in line for.
Another one, I think. It's just stuck.
Sal in Jersey. Hey, Sal.
Hey, Ron. You certainly put ketchup on an egg sandwich.
I would never do that.
I would never do it, but I have seen people do it before.
I would never have an egg sandwich.
Under really? Any circumstances.
Well, I just think that if you're going to eat an egg and go healthy, why wrap the bread around it?
For deliciousness and convenience.
This is the first time I've ever heard that an egg was healthy.
Oh,
egg whites, yeah. But if you leave the yolk in, not healthy.
Oh, well, there you go.
I know two people who ate an egg sandwich and dropped dead while they were doing
it.
Oh,
my God.
Yeah. No.
But was it the yolk or the bread?
No. One was John Kennedy, and he was in a car at the time. Yeah. Fell backwards. Here's, let's go to Glenn. Glenn, go ahead.
Hi, Ronnie.
Yeah.
Afternoon. Hey, what about a meatloaf sandwich for one? You put ketchup on that. And the other thing was the hot dogs. I think the big thing is, the hot dogs and beans. That's why people don't consider it a sandwich.
Well, yeah, I mean, you can, there's other foods. I mean, you can eat turkey separately, but we all agree if you put it on bread, it's a turkey sandwich.
Right. I've had meatloaf and beans.
Wait, I've just now started to think of something because I was thinking of my bread point,
yeah.
That the bread is the issue with the hot dog.
Right, go ahead.
A lobster roll is not much different
That's
than a
good.
Hot dog bun, the bread that they use. And I would absolutely call this a sandwich. I'm starting to feel like I'm wrong.
Can I tell you something? Before I bit into a lobster roll, I went, this is going to be terrible because bread doesn't go with lobster.
Yes.
But what did I didn't realize is that bread is soaked in butter.
Oh, God. Now, we could start doing that for hot dogs.
I was actually like this. It's soaked in butter. It's so tasty. You know, the buttery. And I thought I wanted a second one, but they're so rich.
They are.
Yeah.
God, that's such a good sandwich.
I have a new theory now that you said that. It's such a good sandwich. I think that you have to have sandwich at the end of it. Because you never say, hey, go in the kitchen and grab me a ham. Or go in the right. kitchen and grab me a turkey.
Right.
You always say, grab me a ham sandwich, grab me a turkey sandwich. So hot dog without sandwich, I think, is not a sandwich.
So we're all saying that a cheeseburger is not a sandwich. It's not the bread that makes it a sandwich.
Yeah, it's its own item. I think that hot dog and burger is maybe in its own category. The only thing that's making me rethink this is now the lobster roll situation. I thought that the problem was the bun. I don't think it is.
Because here's a weird thing. A grilled cheese, we don't say sandwich. And that's only cheese. It's melted cheese on bread.
Right.
And it'll be in the sandwich section of right. any menu.
True.
You know, delicious. My grandmother used to call them grilled cheese sandwiches, so now I'm wondering if that's just everything was a sandwich before.
They were so enthralled with bread.
It was a newfangled thing.
This is amazing.
Yeah.
They just started slicing it.
I had a grandfather who would take a fish, throw it on a roll or on bread and just start eating it, even though we'd caught it. And I know it would be like, you got bones in there. And he'd be like, yeah, but the bread gets rid of the bones. I'm like, you're a crazy
old person.
You're a crazy old person.
Oh, my God.
The bread gets rid of the bones, really.
No, it doesn't. You're eating a fishbone sandwich.
My dad was so bad at cleaning fish that he would ball up bread into little balls, so you'd have to swallow them like vitamins if there was a bone stuck in your throat. He was a great guy.
By the way, bones stuck in the throat was like terrifying to me when I was a kid. Reading fish.
Yes.
Yeah.
And really I thought for sure I was dead. And the weird thing is, it reminded me of what a fish must have went through when we caught it.
It's payback time.
Yeah. It's payback time.
Almost dislocate your jaw trying to get it out of your throat.
Here's Frank in Syracuse.
Bennington, how are you?
What's up?
A sandwich is two pieces or more of bread. A roll is one piece. That's what makes a sandwich. Okay. Two pieces of bread or more.
But so, if you have a turkey sandwich on a roll, that you're eating a sandwich. You split the roll, you put the turkey on. That's a sandwich, my friend.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm the smartest person in the world, and I've read this severely. Two pieces of bread or more makes a sandwich.
Well, I don't know, but because a hoagie is a sandwich, a po' boy is a sandwich, a cheesesteak.
And you're simply just splitting down a one piece roll.
Yeah, because bread came from a loaf initially.
This is right. I'm telling you.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks, guys.
He said, I'm telling you. I mean, listen, you guys can argue, but I'm telling you.
I'm right and I'm out.
I'm out.
I read this before my reading took me to this place. So it really comes down to whatever we thought as a kid. It doesn't seem like anyone's changing their mind on anything. Keith, what's up?
Hey, Ronnie Two Bucks, how you doing?
What do you say, buddy?
Okay, I was completely agreeing with you that a hot dog is a sandwich. Had an argument, and somebody put it to me this way. If I went to his house and he offered me a sandwich and then came out with a hot dog, you would look at him like he was a complete lunatic.
I don't think I would look like him. If I said, could I have a sandwich? And he goes, I got hot dogs. I'd be like, great. Why don't we fucking fry some of them up?
Can I have two?
Because I get really hungry. I mean, a hot dog is not going to fill me up.
It tastes good.
But if somebody said to me, oh, yeah, I could make some sandwiches. And I said, see ya. And I said, sure. And then they told me, I'll make you a hot dog sandwich. What I would then assume in my mind is this person was going to take two slices of bread and start cutting hot dog discs and put that on the bread.
What a huge leap.
That would be insane now. That's what you mean.
And a tough sandwich to eat with those discs.
No one's ever done that in their life.
But that's what it sounds like to me.
I did it as a kid, yeah. I would do that to feel like I was making something versus just heating something up. I would cut it and then put it on two pieces.
Would you cut it long way?
I would cut it short way.
Like a little disc.
Like a little disc.
There's no such thing as disc.
Yeah, like the little dogs? Saucers.
Yeah. That's gross.
Yeah, I know that now. I've changed my ways.
Like the way you would mix it into macaroni and cheese.
If I got to my friend's house and they said, I'm going to make you a sandwich, I'd leave because that's fucking creepy.
If my friend offered to make me a sandwich, I'd just say, bless you. Thanks for the sandwich, dude.
You are a saint. No matter what you bring out.
Yeah. That's like if somebody says, mind if I mix you a drink? You can.
Yes.
Go ahead. Now, a sandwich, the idea of sandwich means closed in, right? You've got two pieces of bread. It doesn't matter what the meat, fish, or fowl is inside that bread, right?
Mm-hmm.
So why are you guys bucking at the pork? You know what I mean? The hot dog has shown itself to be a sandwich. And I'm going to go so far, even though it hasn't come up, even a ketchup-laden cheeseburger has to be a sandwich. There's no other way for it.
I think that you have a point, because I think it's just perception. There's no reason that we have been thinking that these things aren't a sandwich.
Yeah, I suppose if you put down what constitutes a sandwich on a piece of paper without what kind of meat or anything, you just did the basics, I think that would...
Yes, we might bread, use here meat, and in my case, preferably cheese, please.
I do want some cheese on that. And you know what? Double down on the cheese. Because I feel like I want to get a nice cheesy taste when I bite into
it. That's just one slice. That's not enough for anyone.
Come on. I know life is hard.
Look at the meat ratio.
Sometimes enough, I replace my bread with cheese and just eat it like that.
Do you put the bread in between that?
No. Nope.
Those slices
just
of cheese.
Hold on to the cheese.
I've put cheese in between ham.
Nice little wrap up that you make. Yeah. Meat wrap.
Like lettuce wraps are big now.
Sure.
Change that
to meat. You've got yourself a snack.
This week on Blue Apron, there's like these Swedish meatballs.
I saw that.
Yeah, I'm very excited about it in a lettuce wrap. Here is Scott. Scott, go ahead.
Hey, Ron. I just want to first say, Chad, it's very pleasure to talk to you, dude. I really enjoy your stand-up.
Thanks.
Yeah, I don't think a hot dog is a sandwich, and here's why. And your previous caller hit it right on the head. A sandwich is in the function of a sandwich. You're sandwiching something between two pieces of bread. So a hot dog, I think, follows along the same lines as a taco or a pita.
That's crazy talk.
Or even a submarine.
A wrap.
I don't know. I'm being pulled in every direction here. I'm fighting myself to be very impressionable with this.
A quesadilla.
Because when he just brought up taco, is the hot dog not our own American taco?
No way!
It isn't.
No,
look,
if you put
a hot dog on a taco shell, sure, I'll call it a hot dog taco. I have no reason not to.
Let's start doing that.
I start using the word fish taco and I'm fine with it. But you're not getting bread with that taco. You're not getting bread with a panini. This is something else.
I feel like he came up with a good point there.
What's the point?
The point is it's not being sandwiched. It's not being held in the same manner. It's displayed. Now, I don't have an answer for the hamburger. The hamburger is still being sandwiched.
Here is Dylan. We're getting further apart now. We were together and we're getting further apart.
Do you think the taco is the sandwich of Mexico? I mean, I think these are different sandwiches for different countries, right?
The torta is the sandwich of Mexico.
Give me a picture of the torta, because I'm not even familiar with this.
It is
Mexican. You just got back from Mexico.
I know.
I would have thought the burrito would be the sandwich of the Mexico.
You would think, wouldn't you, Chris?
That's what I did.
All right, let's take a look at the torta. Well, that's a definite sandwich.
The torta is a sandwich.
Oh, wow. Yeah, God, my taco theory sucks shit. Sorry about that. I didn't even know those existed.
Yeah, and they're great.
Are they?
Oh, yeah.
What's so inside? Good.
Avocado, cheese.
Sometimes a pork, sometimes.
Al pastor.
Like, right, yeah.
You struck oil, guys. Stop. Really.
Peas, corn.
I will eat a torta right now.
They're delicious. Chad Daniels is in the studio. Chad's performing.
Oh, you're doing a plug.
I'm plugging it up. Chad's performing at Comedy on State in Madison, Wisconsin, November 19th through the 21st. Go to madisoncomedy.com for tickets. He'll also be performing at Dr. Grin's in Grand Rapids, Michigan, December 3rd through the 5th. Go to bob.com/Dr. Grin's Comedy. You can pick up Chad's albums, Busy Being Awesome and You're the Best, on iTunes.
You know, Chris, I'm going to go back to you while we're doing this.
Okay.
Which side are you on now?
It's a sandwich, a sandwich side now.
You didn't start that way, though, right?
No, I did.
It was anti-sandwich.
I've been pulled.
This is 12 Angry Men. What we're happening here is everybody's going in one direction.
I just want to see the game.
Hey, Devin, what's up?
Me and my wife pretty much had the same conversation the other day. She was having some friends over, and she wanted to make some cucumber sandwiches for them. I'm like, that's not a sandwich. It's just a piece of bread with sour cream on it.
or cream cheese and cream a cheese. Cucumber on top.
It's a girl's sandwich. Obviously, a guy doesn't want a cucumber sandwich. But my mom made tomato sandwiches every day in the summer.
But that's what I would call that? like a little finger food, like a little luncheon sandwich. You know what I mean? Like, do you want to eat a giant cucumber sandwich? No, but you'll have like a little mini one.
Could you put summer sausage and cheese between two crackers and call that a sandwich? A little finger food sandwich.
First of all, I would eat anything between two crackers. It doesn't get served enough, in my opinion.
So good.
Yeah. Well, Chris, what is your thing that you put on crackers all the time, you said?
Cream cheese?
No, you said, I forget, there was something. Oh, you're a tuna fish?
Oh, yeah, you're a tuna man.
I'll make a bunch of tuna fish and have it as like a dip. And then I just dip it up with some crackers, and I'll just eat the tuna fish, because I love tuna fish so much.
Now, would you consider that a sandwich, or is it a crackery dip?
If I could sandwich the tuna fish paste in between two crackers, then I have a mini sandwich.
This
Otherwise,
is getting crazy.
Have you ever...
Peanut butter and jelly crackers? Yeah. You wouldn't say you just had a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. You wouldn't just say, I just had 8 peanut butter and jelly sandwiches.
Oh, I'm full. All right, Tom Sharpling just sent this to us.
What's that?
Chris Stanley likes burritos because they look like giant pills.
Hey, Sharpling, I'm a goddamn Vice correspondent now, all right?
Well, explain it to him now in case he wasn't listening earlier.
Tom Sharpling, in Vice magazine, they wrote me up saying that Chris Stanley is a budding Periscope star. Specifically, Chris Scope Bros Stanley. So, in your face, Sharpling.
By the way, what gives them the right to say that you're Scope Bros? Because you only talked about Scope Bros, but you never said you're not Scope Bros.
I now have another nickname.
I love that your arm's in a sling and you still had enough energy to get your quotes up for Scope Bros.
Yeah, that's for Sharpling.
By the way, when they do that to you, it's like when you only have one hit. You know what I mean?
Yes.
That's when they're going to put the name of that hit in between your name like that.
Now, I just want to say, Chris, I know that you were upset with the comments that Tom Sharpling made that said that your camera work was less than.
Yeah.
But don't you feel like him saying that has really made you kind of raise the bar? And maybe he kind of helped.
I don't think Vice would even notice you without Sharpling.
Yeah, and I think he improved you. You know what I mean?
The bar was always this high. Sharpling was just taking shots at me. He's just a hater. That's what his problem is. And now I'm fucking Vice correspondent. I'm going to Brazil next week.
You're not a Vice correspondent. They just said something
nice
about you.
That's not how that works.
I don't think any of their correspondents came because they saw them in a Periscope.
They were once in an article.
I got a new show on Viceland. It's their new TV network. It's called Smoking with Chris.
Are they really going to have their own TV network?
Yeah, they just released like a 10-minute-long trailer about all the shows that are going to be on it. Still didn't seem like I could fill a network, but all the shows are there.
Get me in with Broadly. I'd like to be in with those ladies.
Me and Shane Smith are going to party later.
Starting tonight, I'm going to end every sentence with, and I'm going to Brazil next week. I really am.
Chris, go ahead.
Hey, so that theory of a sandwich having two pieces of bread doesn't make sense because you got open-faced sandwiches. So would that make like a hot dog like an open-faced sandwich then?
I'm going to be honest with you. I don't consider an open-faced sandwich a sandwich at all because you can't pick it up.
It's impossible.
Right. Well, then a hot dog would be kind of like an open-faced sandwich. Like a chili dog, you can't really pick that up.
No, you can pick it up. Of course you can.
Not always. Not a good one.
What are you doing? Eating it with a knife and fork?
Well, yeah, if it's
then you sit down to pee, my friend. You sit down to pee.
You're a freak.
All right. Now, Chef Darren is somebody I've long trusted and know from this world. We'll let him be the definitive judge on this. Chef Darren, it's up to you.
The hot dog is definitely a sandwich. A sandwich is defined by anything in bread that you could put toppings on and you could eat with one hand.
So if it's anything inbred, would that be West Virginia Cousins?
But you have to be able to hold it in one hand, Ron. So
you got to be able to hold it in one hand. Inbred.
Because that's what the Earl of Sandwich invented.
Can you hold it
in one hand? So I present to you a Noma hot dog as a definitive answer that it is a sandwich.
Chef Darren, you make a really good case there. It's got to be held.
Yeah, it's definitely a handheld
God, I've believed every single person that's called in.
Me too.
I've changed my mind after every call.
I keep flipping back and forth.
I haven't. I've been locked in from the beginning that hot dog is a sandwich, cheeseburger is a sandwich.
Your confidence has made me feel that way, though. Like, now I'm back in that neck of the woods.
The problem is I'm not open to any new ideas. You know what I mean? I'm Old Testament.
Sure.
You know what I mean? I'm like one of those old Hasidic Jews over in Brooklyn screaming and spitting on women for wearing open-toed shoes. You know, that's what I've become. And I'll be yelling at people, you're eating a sandwich! You know, and it was like, just relax, dude. We're not bothering you. Here is James in California.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, okay. So I was thinking that you call it a hot dog because of the hot dog you're putting inside of it. You know what I mean?
Oh, okay.
Wait, what?
Like, fuck, I mean, I guess you could call it a sandwich because you're putting toppings and meat in it, but, like, in any other sandwich, you're not putting some, just, like, one piece of meat. You know, hot dog is completely different than any other piece of meat.
That's not true. I mean? You could have a chicken sandwich. You could have a turkey sandwich.
You're not going to put a whole drumstick in a fucking piece of bread.
No, not a drumstick, but you're going to put pieces of it in. A sausage. Do you guys think of sausage sandwich as a sandwich? Because it's put into the sandwich section.
Right. Yeah, I mean, that point alone kind of could make you flip. Because certainly those, you know, the big sausage rolls.
Look, here's what's happened in this country during the last century of the American Empire. Mm-hmm. The hot dog and hamburger became so popular that we believed that they could stand on their own, that you could just have a hot dog place or a hamburger place. But the fact of the matter is, they're in the greater family, the family of sandwich.
Right.
Wow. Preach.
And that doesn't change your mind. I don't know what will.
I think the hamburger, like you said, was a hamburger sandwich at one point. Got cocky, went the way of Madonna.
Right.
Just one name. And now it's kind of out there lost.
And yet still, you know, doing a bang up job for itself.
Yeah. I mean, that definitely doesn't go in the sandwich section. That's its own section on the menu.
What's that?
Burgers.
Yeah, I know. I can't get around that. I mean, I have to pay attention to what's in the menu. And I do know for a fact that there will be a burger section on any menu in America.
Or sometimes from the grill.
What do you have from the grill? We got to start asking people that. I'm looking for anything from the grill.
You know what?
Well, that's all of our food.
I'm actually looking for something from the fryer. What do you have in that department?
I'm at the point now that if I eat anything from the fryer, I might as well say, could you just stab me in the chest while I'm waiting? I'll just have a glass of iced tea. And if you could just start because anything from the fryer will kill me now. Will literally kill me. I might as well eat a hand grenade.
I'm looking for a section that was originally in the refrigerator and then eventually on the frying pan. What do you have in that section?
Do you have anything with freezer burn? I would love it.
Now, do you have you're from Minnesota, right?
Yeah.
Is there a sandwich that's just known from your place?
Juicy Lucy.
A specialty.
Juicy Lucy. That's in the hamburger category.
Right.
Yeah, because you're a Minnesota guy, right?
I am, yep.
Yeah.
I live in northern Minnesota, yeah.
Northern Minnesota. Yeah.
Correct.
So you look down on those lower Minnesota people.
I'm from St. Paul.
Yeah. So I
feel like Katniss going into the Capitol.
It's really what it's like.
Really, for both of you guys, it's more like Fargo. You know what I mean? It's the movie Fargo.
That's
your whole life.
That's how we see you.
It's kind of where I live.
Is it?
Mm-hmm.
You watching the TVs?
No, I got burned too many times, so I'm going to wait till it's done and then watch it all.
You don't have to worry. It's unfucking believable.
It's good. Okay.
You could start. Matter of fact, I might start with you right now. I'm going to get my phone. You and I are just going to sit over there. You'll be watching, and I'll be watching you going, right. But it's so good.
No,
Chris,
like,
are you caught up?
This part.
Yeah. I'm not caught up.
You're not caught up?
You didn't watch it?
I haven't watched it yet. I still have to get that next episode.
You're crazed.
I'm caught up to this week. I'm not caught up yet.
Is the mom, where you are, and is the mom dead or alive?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
What?
alive.
Okay, good.
I just gave it away. What the fuck? I guess you spoil everything for me now.
Oh, I'll spoil something else. You're not in Life Vice magazine, and it'll never happen.
It's not real.
You're not going to Brazil.
Real. It is. It's all real. Periscope.
Here's Joey in New Rochelle. Joey.
Buddies.
Yeah.
What a surprise. Chris flip-flopped your side of the fence, Ron.
I know. He is a kiss-up. There's no doubt about it.
This is a flip-flopping crazy-ass day.
Oh, boy. But anyway, no right person, only animals do not cut their sandwiches in half. And as far as I know, I've never seen someone cut their hot dog in half before they ate it.
Is the split top, though, essentially a halving of sorts?
First of all, I love the way that he just delivered it in a way that he
You're
felt like
animal.
he was like a lawyer. It was just, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, have you ever seen anyone split a hot dog?
And then mic drop.
No, that would be an insane thing. If somebody was asked you to split a hot dog, that would not be a shareable food.
I remember when I said the menu, because they have their own burger thing.
Yeah.
This was written to me. Please, Ron, don't let the menu define you. Here is Sean, Mass. Sean.
Hey, what's up? I got a different opinion because growing up, my dad would cut the hot dog in half, take two of them, cut them in half, fry them up, put them in between two pieces of sandwich, throw some sauerkraut mustard on it, and that's it. Bread was bread. It's a fucking sandwich.
Done. Craig.
Although I think he's a little homophobic, though. I just don't think he wanted the hot dog.
Some people worry about that.
Yeah.
Craig in New Haven.
Hey, Ron, first of all, the guy that hates Stevie Nicks, I hope he gets cancer.
Well, that's not nice.
Thank you.
I understand your feelings, though.
Louis Lunch in New Haven invented that hamburger.
It did.
It's still served on toast, so it is a sandwich. Now,
and it comes out of those little weird things, right?
Yeah.
Like little holes in the wall.
This is a funny point. When my friends, we used to share a pizza, like I'd be selfish and I'd take the two slices and I'd put them like a sandwich. See what I'm saying? Crust to crust. Would that be a sandwich?
It's a pizza sandwich?
Well, it's really what I would call a John Travolta because you got to put them both on. But, you know, essentially, some people would look at. I mean, I'm going to give you one now. I'll just leave it out there. Is a bagel a sandwich?
No, a bagel is not a sandwich.
Bagel is not a sandwich. It goes in the same.
You didn't even wrestle with this.
You can't fuck a sandwich.
I would maybe take a moment to consider if you're talking about adding lox to said sandwich.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Like if you added lox to a bagel, I might start to think about it a little more. But that's essentially a baked item with a fat spread, much like toast is with butter.
Well,
you know
this.
I mean?
If you eat a bagel from a calorie point of view, it's the same as if you ate a loaf of bread.
Yes.
And I'm not even making yes. that up. I've read that. Where they go, this is like, and I thought, what if you had two bagels because you were really hungry? Is that two loaves or?
I'm just asking for a friend.
That's why it's so good.
I kind of feel like I've used a bagel as a sandwich before, though.
To put other meats and cheeses and things. Sure. But if we're just talking with cream cheese.
By the way, you can't put meats and cheeses if there's Jews around.
I know.
You have to act like, oh, I'm taking this home to keep separate.
To be honest with you, it's why I often struggle with the Jewish delicatessen type sandwiches. Because I am a fan of cheese. I'd like to see a cheese involved with a sandwich.
You're a you're an Italian deli type person.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. It's a different world, really. When you look at how much the Italians care about cheese. And and the fact that the Jews don't want to mix their meats and cheeses.
Honestly, I think that's our greatest difference. Because there's a lot of similarities there.
Mm-hmm. And it's not accepting Christ as a savior.
That's minor compared to the cheese rules. We can see past that.
Well, we've got packed phones, but we got to wrap this up. It went by fast, though.
It certainly did.
Today, I did Opie's show. We couldn't get anybody interested in a lost baby, but we were trying to get help for it. But this What Is a Sandwich started a fire.
It's very passionate.
People don't like to help, but everybody has an opinion.
It's true. Yeah. And people, the simpler and dumber something is, people will care about more. You know, we could talk about free trade. We'd watch these calls just fall off one after another.
And tonight there's going to be bar fights. It's a fucking sandwich.
Don't you ever fucking come back here. You're not my brother anymore.
Chad Daniels is performing at Comedy on State in Madison, Wisconsin, November 19th through the 21st. Go to madisoncomedy.com for tickets. He'll also be performing at Dr. Grin's in Grand Rapids, Michigan, December 3rd through the 5th. Go to thebob.com/Dr. Grin's Comedy for tickets. On Twitter, it's at ChadDaniels34. And you can go to ChadDaniels.com to pick up his albums, Busy Being Awesome and You Are the Best.
Chad, thanks so much for coming by, buddy.
Thanks for having me in, you guys.
We'll see you next time you're in town.
Sounds good.
And we'll see everybody else again in 1974.
Ladies and gentlemen, the evening is over. We hope you all enjoyed yourselves, and we'll see you all again in 1974. Good evening! Yeah!